Welcome to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, your host on this Wednesday, July 1st, 2015. Alex Jones is going to be joining us in the next segment. He's going to be talking about some very important issues. Things are really coming to a head in so many different ways. We've got Obama removing the TPP's anti-slavery clauses, while at the same time he pats himself on the back for taking a principled stand by removing a Confederate flag. Total symbolism over substance. But even worse than that, Alex is going to be talking about Obama's secret directives. These are not executive orders. These are secret orders that are like executive orders, except they're not published. You know, we have secret laws, we have secret courts, we have secret dictates from our not so secret dictator anymore. We all know what this is about. He's also going to be talking about the recent court decision in Oklahoma. The Supreme Court there just removed a Ten Commandments monument, saying that it was establishing a religion. No, what it was doing was establishing the foundation of our laws, of our cultures, but it's necessary for us to remove those foundations. That's what this is really about. Look, they have the Magna Carta on the door of the Supreme Court. They have eight panels showing our various things that they think were very important in terms of developing the rule of law. Magna Carta was one of those. We understand where our foundations for our culture come from. If we look at the Declaration of Independence, it's very important that we understand that our rights don't come from men. They come from God. You should support that even if you're an atheist. Support the idea of that, because you know what? If you don't acknowledge God as the source of your rights, you are going to have men who act as if they're God. We're also going to talk about, of course, the nine-ring race. They've been very busy this week, the Supreme Court. Nazgul has been busy handing out their edicts, just like our executive tyrant who is putting out his orders. They have their orders as well. We're going to talk about the voting rights decision that they came up with. They put it out as a voting rights. Actually, it's taking away the ability of states to ask for proof of citizenship at the voting booths. An amazing piece of overreach for them in the first place, legislatively, whether you agree with it or not. And we're going to talk about some other Supreme Court decisions, like their decisions on the shutting down the war on coal from the EPA that Obama was pushing them to do. I agree with that decision, but not the way they did it. It's like when we had Lionel on the other day. He was saying that he agreed with several of the issues, but he didn't like the way they did it. We have to maintain a rule of law. If we go to a dictatorship, you may like the way that's being dictated today, but you're not going to like it tomorrow. We cannot have the arbitrary rule of nine politically appointed judges for life who have been corrupted by this power, like nine ring race. We're also going to talk about the vaccination situation. We're going to see people's reactions to it. We're going to talk about what's going to happen to that, because there's going to be court challenges. It may go all the way to the Supreme Court, because we have seen that the Ninth District Court really doesn't respect privacy and individual freedom. Look at their decision on the confiscation of 30% of the crop of the raisin farmers. That was okayed by the Ninth District Court. The FDA for, I guess it was right after World War II, they started going in and saying, we're going to take 30% of your crop. You have nothing to say about it. As we pointed out, that's worse then serfs were treated in medieval times. They only had to pay 10% or 15% to their feudal lord. No, the FDA would just come in and confiscate 30% of their crops. No compensation. The Ninth District Court said, yeah, that's okay. So it had to go all the way to the Supreme Court. They ruled, actually, in that case, they made an intelligent legal decision. Not just because I agree with it. They actually referred to law. They just didn't make a pronouncement. We're also going to be joined in the second hour with Ben Fuchs as well as Anthony Gucciardi. We're going to be talking about some vital health issues. If you don't prepare for your health and things go down like they're going down in Greece, and we'll talk about Greece as well, you're going to be in a difficult position. So prepare ahead. Stay with us. We'll be right back with Alex Jones talking about these recent decisions.
Ladies and gentlemen, Alex Jones here with some of the clearest evidence ever that the bottom has now fallen out. We have now reached the event horizon, not just here, but all over the world. Tyranny is launching offensives on every front. David Knight is going to be coming up breaking more of this down. Again, I am your host, Alex Jones. incredible. Let me just mention the headlines I've got here. Ten Commandments statue must be removed from state capitol. Oklahoma Supreme Court rules. Boom. Voting rights advocate gets win at Supreme Court. Illegals can basically vote. No proof of citizenship to be shown. And you have states issuing driver's license to anybody that wants them. It's on. California, on the last day of June, the 30th, boom, governor signed SB 277 for forced inoculation, getting rid of the religious exemption. This is a war on religious beliefs, conscience, you name it. And then that dovetails with what we covered a lot yesterday. Obama removes TPP's anti-slavery clause, which is still going on in Dubai and other areas, then attacks Confederate flag, a symbol of slavery, and Obama issues 19 classified directives changing laws passed by Congress. We're going to be going over all of this here in just a moment. But when you look at this, you can see that it's all being expanded so that we're hit with so much tyranny we can't respond to it. It's a war on language, a war on communication. Just as three top comics have recently come out, Jerry Seinfeld and others, and said political correctness is destroying language and the capability to even communicate. And these are liberals. His 13-year-old daughter, they said, hey, we're moving back to New York City so you can meet more boys and have more friends. She said, girls and boys together is sexist. The word boys and girls is sexist. Brown bags are racist. Dig up Confederate generals. Get rid of their bodies. This is the insanity that we're facing. Now let's explain something. We have a separation of church and state, meaning the government cannot announce an official religion. But they've expanded that, violating the First Amendment that says Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof. They have expanded that ultra-massively and twisted it to say at your commencement, it's your free speech. You can read a poem if you're speaking, if you're the valedictorian. Or salutatorian, you could talk about how you love your mom or your dad, talk about how you love the principal, love the school, love track, love field, love football, love Harry Potter, love the moon goddess, or love Jesus Christ, or love Muhammad. But now they say, no, you specifically can't talk about Christianity or Judaism. Everything else is accepted. Everything else is okay. Well, now, first story. Ten Commandments statue must be removed from state capitol. Oklahoma Supreme Court rules. AP, Oklahoma Supreme Court said Ten Commandments monument, state capitol must be removed because it indirectly benefits the Jewish and Christian faiths in violation of the state's constitution. The court ruled Tuesday that the Oklahoma Constitution bans using public property to benefit a religion, and the Ten Commandments are obviously religious in nature. You know what's on the top of most major capitals? It's called the Goddess of Columbia. You know, the capital structure itself goes back to Greece and Rome, and it was for temples to the goddess. It is abreast. The arched doorways, this is mainline history, are an entrance into the woman, and that law comes out of the goddess. These are temples. Are you going to ban those? Christmas trees are Germanic and Druid trees that were brought in during the middle of winter to symbolize evergreen, and the greenness would come back in the cold of the winter. Are you going to ban Christmas trees? Everything has some religious connotation and connection. And this is a war on ideas that can be selectively enforced where anything can be removed. And it's very discriminatory. They allow the Druids and the pagans and the neo-pagan groups, the Wiccans, to promote and to proselytize on basis. But they don't let Christians do it. There have been Texas cases and others where they find a little girl with a Bible in her bag and they throw it away. Well, she's allowed to have a Bible, or she's allowed to have the Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe in her, which is also a Christian allegory, in her bag. This is the persecution of free speech going on and the ignorance of the public, where they're aware of every mindless, imagined, racist problem. And if you don't go along with Obamacare and gun control, you're racist as well. It's the new religion. But they're not aware of their basic freedoms. This is unprecedented. And it's all coming down with gay marriage. Marriage was an ancient institution in every culture about men and women coming together. If people want to have civil unions or states want to legalize it, that's their issue. But again, it becomes a diversion and a distraction and also an overwrite, a war against everything that was primal, everything that was basic, everything that makes a species. This is a globalist overwrite, in their own words, of culture and society, breaking us down past the individual where we can't stand up for each other. There's a war on fathers in all the media and all the culture, and that's ultimately a war on women. This is a destructive agenda, sold as neoliberalism to free, when actually it is to enslave, when all of our other basic freedoms are being taken. Illegals can get free welfare and have their babies for free, and they can vote, Supreme Court. And now, California a few years ago passed a law that parental consent doesn't matter now, down to age 11. They could give kids $200 discount cards if they would say, I want to be inoculated. And then the school comes in and says, they make the decisions for your kid. The pedophiles also want to move it down to age 11 and say that they can give consent. Well, they can't because they're not grown up yet. Just like you can't say, well, your 11-year-old wanted me to give him a bottle of Jack Daniels. You're contributing to the delinquency of a minor. You don't have a right to push that on them. This is outsiders, the state, corporations, control freaks, wanting to run our children. California vaccinations bill, SB 277, signed by governor, becomes law. A California bill that removes all exemptions to vaccine requirements for school entry, and then it goes in through the system. This is unprecedented. A California bill that removes all exemptions to vaccine requirements for school entry except those medically indicated has just become law. After being passed through the assembly on Thursday and the state Senate passed the same version, it's now been signed by Governor Jerry Brown into law. They want to make us take hundreds of vaccines. This is so precedent setting. And now they know more and more doctors are coming out saying vaccines are dangerous. Don't give them to pregnant women and stuff like that. Read the inserts. So hospitals are ordering doctors and medical centers are ordering doctors that they aren't allowed to say vaccines are dangerous, taking control of medical decisions from you and your doctor. That's what Obamacare, that's really corporate screw you care, is. And here's an example of that. KXAN here in Austin, Texas, where InfoWars comes to you. Austin Regional Clinic won't accept unvaccinated children. Strengthening vaccination policy post-measles outbreak that killed no one. But they hyped it up. They have a secret vaccine fund. They've paid out to tens of thousands of people whose kids died. They keep that very quiet, though it's admitted. But no one dies from measles. The measles, mumps, and rubella shot admits it can give you type 1 diabetes. They claim it's genetic, but it can give you diabetes. The insert openly says that. Give you all these other diseases, neurological disorders, you name it. And now they're going to intimidate you when you come in and your kid's already sick and you want to get health care. And they go, show us the records or we'll refuse care. Talk about do no harm. And now they're going to try to force it. This is a war on people's freedom. The answer is find the clinics, find the vaccine choice clinics in your area and support them. Fight them with your dollars and the free market. There is a full-out war against choice, a full-out war against freedom, a full-out war against sovereignty, a full-out war against cash. The global meltdown is coming, and they're getting it lined up to use it to bring in full control. And finally, Leanne McAdoo made this point on the nightly news. Jerry Brown, when SB 277 hits your desk, this is what he said when he was in office the last time. In 2011, he's been in office three times. He's back in now. He said to California members of the state Senate on a bicycle helmet for kids. They wanted to put parents in jail if your kid didn't wear a bicycle helmet. He said, while I appreciate the value of wearing a ski helmet, I am concerned about the continuing and seemingly inexorable transfer of authority from parents to the state. Not every human problem deserves a law. I believe parents have the ability and responsibility to make good choices for their children. What changed now? The big vaccine makers came in. They literally pumped in hundreds of millions of dollars, not just here, but all over the world, Australia, countries in Europe. They're banning kids 11 years old playing in their backyards now. This is the end of parents. This is the end of freedom. This is the total takeover of society. And then that ties into what David Knight's going to come up and be talking about next here. On the radio transmission / TV, Obama removes TPP's anti-slavery clause, then attacks Confederate flag as symbol of slavery. precedented that they're going to say globally slavery's okay because it's bigger than ever, as Ja'Kari Jackson broke down a few weeks ago in a report. And then that ties into his 19 classified directives that he signed a few days ago that are secret. Not only do they rule by executive fiat now, but what's in it is secret. So David Knight is going to be breaking that down as well. I've got pressing corporate and family issues that are going to be handled today as we prepare a major launch on the television and more. But David Knight's coming up, and I'll be back live tomorrow. We're going to go to break. Stay with us. David Knight coming up with the main transmission jam-packed. Call your friends and family. Tell them, tune in right now. This is the defense of the Republic. This is the defense of humanity. We can say no. All other tyranny has fallen when the people resist. All that evil men and tyrants seek to flourish is that good men and women do nothing. We'll be back. This is the InfoWar, the fight for human liberty worldwide.
Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show on this Wednesday, July 1st, 2015. The year is going pretty quickly, and we're going to talk about what's going to come up in 2016 in just a moment. The government is going to be putting forth real ID. You don't know what that is, we'll tell you about it, but you're going to need to have real ID, not your driver's license, to fly. Nevertheless, the Supreme Court just said that we cannot ask for any proof of citizenship when people vote. Get your head around that kind of inconsistency. We're going to talk about the non-legal basis of this Supreme Court decision, as well as the non-legal basis of their decision against the EPA and their regulations coming from the Obama administration to shut down coal plants. That was something that has been, that's an objective, a goal of Obama since before he was elected, while he was running. He was looking to shut down the coal industry. I'm glad that they have not done it at this moment, but when you look at the logic that the Supreme Court came up with, it's equally troubling. Whether you agree with them on the issues or not, that's the point. When we look at their decision on marriage, their decision on Obamacare, their decision on coal, on voter ID, none of it makes any sense from a legal perspective. It is just raw edicts. And that's what we're seeing from Obama. This is very troubling. This is an article that is on New American. Obama issues 19 classified directives changing laws that have been passed by Congress. Okay, now, this is from the New American. They say, since being inaugurated in 2009, President Obama has issued 30 presidential policy directives, PPDs, PPDs. Not to be confused with TPPs, these are PPDs, 19 of which he has ordered to keep secret from Congress and the American people. But like the TPP, the PPDs are also secret. We're not allowed to see them. We're just supposed to obey them. Congress can't see them either, like the TPP. Now, USA Today breaks this down. They say, of the 30 issued by him, 19 have not been released. 11 of those, the White House has not disclosed even what the subject is. We're not even allowed to know what the subject is, let alone the details of this. They say, and this is USA Today, this is quote-unquote your mainstream media here, it's not only the public that doesn't have copies, it's also Congress that doesn't have copies. They said they have the same legal force as an executive order. They form a body of largely secret law. How could we have secret law in this country? Isn't that an oxymoron? No, it isn't, quite frankly, because the law is not there to do anything other than entrap you in this society. Continuing on with what they say, this is from a political scientist who advised Congress on national security directives before he retired from the Congressional Research Service. He said, the difference is that while executive orders are public by law, in other words, they must be published in the Federal Register before they become effective, the PPDs, the presidential policy directives, are not published. He says it's kind of a secret law. People have to obey it. But it's a directive that can allocate money, it can direct people, or it can take a course of actions. See, in postmodern America, post-constitutional America, we have secret laws. We have secret treaties that are about to come down the pike. And then we have even secret courts. You know, the FISA court meets in secret. They make decisions that they say modify the Constitution. I would say no. I disagree with Marbury versus Madison, just like Jefferson did. The Supreme Court gave themselves that power. So they have a Supreme Court decision that says, you know, we've decided that we're going to set in judgment as the final arbiter of whether or not any law can be used or whatever a president does. No, we have division of power. That's precisely what the founders of this country were concerned about. That's why they not only divided power amongst the states that had created the central government, they were worried that that creature of the states was going to become a Frankenstein monster, even though Frankenstein hadn't been written by Mary Shelley at that point. People understood that was something that could happen. So they divided power as well as they could amongst kept power, retained power, I should say, by the states that had created the central government, retained power by the people that had created the states and the central government. And then within the central government, they divided power. That's why when the Supreme Court made their decision about the second National Bank of the United States, Andrew Jackson said, well, they've made their decision. Let's see them enforce it. We need to have that kind of attitude from people today. We need to have people elected to office that understand that they are not at the mercy of these nine ring race at the Supreme Court who have been totally corrupted by power. Power corrupts. Absolute power corrupts absolutely. We see that with them. We see that with Obama and his secret laws. We can't even know what the subjects are. Stay with us. We're going to also talk about the TPP, both from the perspective of Obama's endorsing slavery within the TPP and what's happening in Greece. Stay with us. We'll be right back. We're going to get back to these articles that we were talking about in the last segment that Alex brought up in the first segment about Obama endorsing literal slavery through the trade agreements. He has now removed prohibitions from that, greasing the way for countries that are involved in slavery today to become our trading partners, you know, because we need those slave goods. I guess they're not getting enough of them at the big box retailers. We're going to go back to that. We're going to talk about the Supreme Court decision as well as what's going on in Greece and some more Supreme Court tyranny. Before we do, though, this hour of the Alex Jones Show is made possible by the support of the high-quality products that we sell at InfoWarsLife.com. Products like Survival Shield, X2, Nascent Iodine. You know, for me, this is a no-brainer. I take it every morning when I get up, and I can really tell the difference. I really needed it today. Last night, I did not get much sleep at all for whatever reason. I could just not fall asleep. It really works. It helps to focus me. I can tell you firsthand that Alex spends a lot of time and money trying to get the best ingredients and getting the best ingredients for all these products. One of my favorite things about X2 is the fact that it's liquid, and it's something that I can take several of these supplements all at once without having to swallow a bunch of pills. I just put them all in one thing and kick it back. It's much easier to take. There's X2 reviews on InfoWarsLife.com. There's over 400 of them. Over 99% of the respondents would recommend it to a friend or family member. Here's one of those. This is from Biker Dave in Port Richie, Florida. He says, I take this product daily. It gives me energy and stamina. Two small doses in the morning, one after lunch are all I need. At almost 65, I can definitely say I easily feel 10 years younger. That's right. You can get your bottle of X2 right now. We're in stock with X2. We've got several products that have sold out, so it's a good time to stock up on that while we've got it in. You can read the other 400 reviews at InfoWarsLife.com. That's InfoWarsLife.com. Now, getting back to the amazing pronouncements that have come out, and I'm still reeling from reading this story about Obama's presidential policy directives, the PPDs. These are things that go even beyond executive orders because we're not even allowed to know what the subjects of these executive orders are. So they're like executive orders, except they're secret. Congress doesn't know what they are. We're not allowed to know what they are, but we must obey them. See a problem with that? I do. I see a lot of problems with that. And you know, when I look at this, I have the same reaction that Jeff Sessions, I don't know if it's, I get their names mixed up. There's a Congressman Sessions and there's a Senator Sessions. Senator Sessions took a look at the Trans-Pacific Partnership. And what he told us about it, he was absolutely appalled. He said, I'm just breathless as to what's going on with this. And I got to say, that's the way I feel this last week. I am just breathless with the insanity and with how quickly everything is moving. With all of this, hopefully it's going to wake people up. Hopefully people will see that this is something that has been rolling out for a very long time. And I want to talk about what's going on with Greece in just a moment and go back to a book that Alex Jones wrote back in 2002. He mentioned it briefly yesterday, and there was a transcript in there of an interview that he had with Greg Palast, and he was talking about interviews that he had had with Joe Stiglitz. Joe Stiglitz has something to say about Greece that is very relevant to today, to what's going on with the bankers there, as well as with these trade agreements. And I want to pull that in. But before we do, I want to get back to the TPP from the story here about the anti-slavery clause. Now, this is an article that came out yesterday evening from Kit Daniels. He points out that right before Obama publicly attacked the Confederate flag as a symbol of slavery, President Obama quietly removed an anti-slavery provision from the Trans-Pacific Partnership Trade Agreement. This partnership bars countries that engage in slavery from being part of major trade deals with the U.S. It was written by Senator Bob Menendez from New Jersey. This is a report from the Huffington Post. They say, at the insistence of the White House, however, Menendez agreed to modify his language to say that as long as a country is taking, quote, concrete steps, unquote, towards reducing human trafficking and forced labor, it can still be a part of the trade deal. Now, the reason they had to do this is because they want to get Malaysia in. Malaysia is a major source of cheap labor, and it's also a major source of human trafficking in Southeast Asia. They have enslaved men, women, and children subjected to forced labor and sex trafficking, according to the State Department, according to this article that Kit Daniels has. And the Huffington Post asks, why in the year 2015 is the White House teaming up with Republican leaders essentially to defend the practice of slavery? But that's okay, because that's being done quietly. Publicly, Obama is going to the black churches singing Amazing Grace. He is removing the Confederate flag because that is all about slavery. He says, well, you know, actually, Lincoln didn't even start the war to end slavery. He started the war to stop secession. If you go back and read some of the original stuff, you'll see they're not calling the people in rebellion. They called them rebels, but mostly they called them secession. You know, Lincoln didn't free the slaves with the Emancipation Proclamation in 1863. That happened in 1865, they finally freed the slaves of Ulysses S. Grant. And if you're historically challenged, he was the commander of the Union forces, and he had slaves on his farm, his wife's farm, until 1865, when they were outlawed, when the amendments went through to do that. Now, that was the 13th Amendment. The 14th Amendment said that they were going to extend due process to the freed slaves. In 1870, they extended voting rights specifically to the slave. So they did these things in the steps of progression because they had to explicitly put it in there. They weren't, these different rights were not being given to the freed slaves. And it's kind of interesting when you look at the Supreme Court decision that came out this week, where they threw out Arizona and Kansas's voter IDs. They had a policy that they would request proof of citizenship before someone could be added to the voter registration rolls. And the Supreme Court says, no, you don't need to do that. They can just tell you they're citizens, and that's okay. You know, really? Is it okay if I just tell the TSA, don't worry, I'm a citizen, I'm not a threat, you don't need to see any documents. You know, these are not the drones you're looking for, just let me through. No, that doesn't work anywhere else. If I refuse to give a police officer my ID when he requests it or demands it, I'm going to wind up face down on the concrete in most situations. That's what we've seen. That's the rules that the federal government is putting out as they federalize police enforcement. But, you know, when we look at voting, this is something that was never defined in the Constitution, who gets to vote. So there were definitions that went through. We had three amendments that have been put in the Constitution to clarify that. In 1870, they added an amendment to allow people to vote regardless of race, color, or previous condition of servitude. So that was 1870. 50 years later, 1920, allowed the right to vote regardless of sex. That gave women the right to vote. Then in 1970, another 50 years. Interesting. These are like 50 years apart. They have the voting age lowered to 18 years. And quite frankly, they did that because they were sending men off to die and not allowing them to vote in the wars. They were drafting people at 18 years of age. So, you know, just like the Constitution doesn't say you've got freedom of speech or freedom of religion, it just says you have those because those rights come from God. That's what the Declaration of Independence tells us. You possess those rights as a human being. So the Constitution is there to say you're not going to infringe on those rights on any kind of basis, not on basis of race, not on the basis of sex or age. That's why we had those three amendments. Now we come back 45 years after this last one, where they gave the vote to 18-year-olds, and the Supreme Court doesn't go through the usual process. Because when you look at these three amendments, they were each 50 years apart. They all had a format to them. They all came in and they said, the right, they had two parts. Section one, the right of citizens of the U.S. to vote shall not be denied or abridged because of fill in the blank, race, sex, age, okay? That was the first part. The second part said, Congress shall have the power to enforce this article by appropriate legislation. In other words, Congress can't write laws when they don't have jurisdiction over something. But see, we're at the point now where the Supreme Court doesn't even wait for Congress to write the laws on things that they don't have jurisdiction. The Supreme Court makes pronouncements on things that even the federal government in no branch has jurisdiction over. And that's what they have done by saying we cannot verify who citizens are. Because in each of these amendments, it was citizens of the United States have the right to vote and cannot be abridged because of this. It is citizens who have that right. But of course, the Supreme Court doesn't need to be bothered with that. They will just make their little declaration. Because as I said before, these are nine kings and queens with the ring of power who have essentially become Nazgul, ring race. Remember the Lord of the Rings? The men who took the power as kings and they were corrupted by it? That's what we have seen. That's what everyone was always concerned about. Lord Acton, who said, power corrupts and absolute power corrupts absolutely. They were concerned. He was concerned. And his contemporaries who founded this country were concerned about the consolidation of power, about people becoming arbitrary dictators. What is a dictator? A dictator is someone who says, the law is in my mouth, essentially. He dictates what that law is. And that's what we have now. Except, of course, you have the presidential policy directives where we cannot even see what the dictates are because those are secret laws. Yes, we have truly gone to a corrupt government where the emperor has no clothes. And one of the things that they have to do with this, of course, is to make sure that they remove all the foundations, historical, legal, of our country. That's what's really behind this removal of the Ten Commandments in Oklahoma, as well as other places. We have monuments at the Supreme Court. When we talked about the 800th anniversary of the Magna Carta, we talked about how that was one of the panels on the door of the Supreme Court. They put monuments up to talk about, this is where our laws came from. We have this long tradition, so forth and so on. And many of the states refer directly to the Magna Carta. We also have a foundation. We talk about America being a Christian nation. That doesn't mean that the majority of people were Christians, although they were. Doesn't mean that the majority of the founders were Christians, although they were. What it means is that our laws were based on that philosophically, ethically. That was the foundation. And that's what people are putting these monuments up. But we have to take the monuments down because we are removing the foundations of our country. We are headed into a Mordor when we give this kind of power to these people. I want to talk about what's going on in Greece next because it is very confusing. Yesterday they defaulted on a $1.7 billion IMF payment, so they are now technically in default to the IMF. But then we see this just a couple of hours ago from CNN Money where Greece does an about-face on the bailout. I want to play the clip of that in just a moment here, but they say, this is CNN Money, just a couple of hours ago, they say, whoa, the Greek government is now ready to sign on to a bailout package it threw out just days ago, but the about-face won't fix the country's crisis anytime soon. And this is what Alexis Tsipras, the prime minister, wrote. He said, Greece is prepared to accept this staff-level agreement subject to the following amendments, additions, or clarifications. It was first reported this morning by the Financial Times. So just as we can't really tell what they're doing. And this happened on Sunday. Drudge Report put out a tweet and they said, Sunday morning, the Greek finance minister says we would never institute cash controls. That's antithetical to everything we believe. And then by that evening, they've closed the banks for a week. We see yesterday that they defaulted technically on this, and now Greece does an abrupt about face today. So I'm not really sure, nobody is really sure what's going on with this. There is some heavy-handedness. It's not just the Greek government that is vacillating all over the place, but it is also the banks, the IMF, that are playing hardball with the people of Greece. And I want to tie this in to what's going on with the bankers, what's going on with the trade agreements, because this all ties together with crony capitalism, with the multinational control of our economies. Look at this article that came out today from Paul Joseph Watson. There's a report from someone on Twitter, Alex Andreo, says that the IMF is ordering U.S. tour operators to withhold payments to Greek hotels. He says, to crush us is their aim. So they don't want U.S. tour operators to actually pay these private companies who provided the services, who need the money so that they can exist. No, we're going to take that, says the IMF. They say the measure illustrates how the IMF is prepared to impose draconian capital controls directly on Greek private business owners in order to recover their debt. They say, if this is true, it's disgraceful. If the IMF is exceeding their authority, I hope they get sued, wrote one respondent to the report. This is pure thuggery, added another. This is what the people of Greece are going through. You got Greek pensioners, people who are retired. They're going to the banks trying to grab their cash. They say in chaotic scenes, thousands of elderly Greeks on Wednesday today besieged the nation's crisis-hit banks, which reopened to allow them to withdraw vital cash from their state pensions. They say Athens has now reopened almost 1,000 bank branches for 3 days to allow pensioners without cards to withdraw $133 to last them the rest of the week. Now, here's one guy. He says, I'm a retired sailor. He asked not to be identified. He told the AFP he had no cash to buy crucial medicine for his sick wife. He said, I worked for 50 years on the sea. Now I am a beggar for 120 euros. I took out the 120 euros, but I have no money for medication for my wife who had an operation and is sick. That's the situation they're in. You know, my parents had had told me stories about when they were children through the Depression. Some of you, perhaps you heard that from your grandparents who are younger than me. We don't have any direct experience of this, but we should be very concerned that we are going to have a direct experience of this. Now, of course, there's also a referendum coming up. The BBC News printed the referendum. You can see that here on the screen. Get a picture of this referendum. Of course, it's all Greek to me. It's all written out in Greek, and the character is completely different, so you can't read it. It's very simple, but they felt that it was a little bit hard to understand. Essentially, it's like, do you want to sign on to the plan that the IMF is putting out there? They said, well, they didn't think that anybody could understand it. However, there's an interesting article from Joseph Stiglitz on The Guardian, and he says how I would vote in the Greek referendum. He says, neither alternative, approval or rejection of the Troika's terms, will be easy. Both carry huge risks. Now, I'm going to tell you what Joseph Stiglitz said, and then I want to read you what Greg Palast talked about back in 2002 with Alex Jones. We have a transcript of that. That's in this book, 9/11, A Descent into Tyranny. Actually, you can also get a PDF copy of that if you're a Prison Planet TV subscriber. That's where I got the information. And I want to tell you what he was saying about the IMF 13 years ago and what he's saying today. Stay with us. We'll be right back. And of course, Greece is technically in default. We don't really know what's going on at the moment. There's a referendum coming up on July the 5th. We've had reports that the Greek government has now reversed their position and is offering to accept some of the deals that have been made to them. But I want to talk to you about the opinions of Joseph Stiglitz on this referendum that's coming up on July 1st, because it has applications to all of us. Now, he is someone who had worked for the World Bank, and back in 2002, Alex Jones had an interview with Greg Palast, who talked about conversations that he had with Joseph Stiglitz and about some of the whistleblowing activities at the time. We'll get to that in just a moment. Before we do, here's what Joseph Stiglitz says about how he would vote if he was voting in the Greek referendum. He says, in terms of transforming a large primary deficit into a surplus, few countries have accomplished anything like what the Greeks have achieved in the last 5 years. Because there's a lot of back and forth as to who's at fault. Are the Greeks at fault? Are they living a profligate lifestyle? Or is this something that is kind of a rope-a-dope by the large banks? Now, this is a guy who worked for the Troika banks, for the central banks, for the World Bank. And this is what he says. He says this has been done through cost in terms of human suffering that's been extremely high. The Greek government's recent proposals went a long way toward meeting its creditors' demand. He said, we should be clear. Almost none of the huge amount of money loaned to Greece has actually gone to Greece. It has gone to pay out private sector creditors, including German and French banks. Greece has gotten only a pittance, but it has paid a high price to preserve those countries' banking systems. The IMF and other official creditors do not need the money that is being demanded. Now, he goes on to break this down to what a yes vote would mean and what a no vote would mean. Here's what he says from a yes vote, from his opinion. And this is a guy who has worked for the IMF and World Bank, Troika, large central bankers. He says a yes vote would mean depression almost without end. Perhaps a depleted country, one that has sold off all of its assets, whose bright young people have immigrated, who might finally get debt forgiveness, perhaps having shriveled into a middle-income economy. Greece might finally be able to get assistance from the World Bank, and that might happen in the next decade or the decade after that. He says, in contrast, however, a no vote would at least open the possibility that Greece, with its strong democratic tradition, might grasp its destiny in its own hands. Greeks might gain the opportunity to shape a future that, though perhaps not as prosperous as the past, is far more hopeful than the unconscionable torture of the president. He says, I know how I would vote. And we've had a lot of people say that. I saw Jim Rogers say that. He said, they ought to just say, look, we're not going to cover the banks. We're not going to. And understand, too, that what's happening with these proposed plans, that some of the money is going to go directly to the IMF in terms of bailing this out. But for the most part, money is going to be coming from sovereign countries like Greece and France to pay off the bankers. In other words, they're going to be assuming Greece's sovereign debt into their countries because we can't have the bankers ever lose any money. So it's going to be on some country's balance sheet. And once they do, once they get it on their balance sheet, then the bankers come around and go, you know, you've got a pretty high debt to income ratio now. I think we're going to have to raise your interest rates. It's the same thing they do to new college graduates. Give you a credit card. Rope-a-dope. Here, try this credit card. Create a new entitlement system here. And then what you do, they say, yeah, you're getting in over your head. I think we're going to have to jack up that interest rate. Looks like, you know, that just isn't going to make it. That's precisely what they're doing. Stay with us when we come back. I'm going to read you what was said about this in 2002, and it applies precisely to what we see happening with the Trans-Pacific Partnerships. Joining us in the next segment will be pharmacist Ben Fuchs as well as Anthony Gucciardi, and we're going to be talking about some health issues. Now is a good time to talk about that because we've just had a violation of our informed consent, something that has some real potential to do damage throughout this country. And of course, it's not just mandatory vaccines. We're seeing everywhere that the government is mandating that we buy their favorite corporations' products. They're no longer just government sponsors. They're no longer just using crony capitalism to burden the competitors of their friends with regulations. No, now they're directly holding a gun to our head. And that's essentially what's going on with these secret trade treaties. We talked earlier in the program about how we not only have, you know, we have the FISA court that has its secret court rulings that they say modify the Constitution, but we're not allowed to see those. We have a secret trade treaty that is going to change everything economically and politically, but we're not allowed to see that. And then, of course, Obama has got his secret presidential policy directives that we're not even allowed to know what the subjects are, but they have the same effect as executive orders. This is absolutely insane. But we see the emperors. We know that they have no clothes. We know they have no authority to do this. This however, as Senator Sessions said, is becoming breathtaking in its implications. We've been talking about Greece, and in this last segment, before we go to pharmacist Ben Fuchs and Anthony Gucciardi, I want to finish up talking about this and go back to an interview in 2002. There's a transcript in this book, 9/11, Descent into Tyranny. It's a book that was written by Alex Jones. You can get the PDF of it if you are a Prison Planet TV subscriber. That's what I did. I looked at this interview, and it's very interesting because they were talking about a debriefing, an interview, some documents that Greg Palast had gotten involving Joe Stiglitz. And I just read some excerpts about Joe Stiglitz's analysis of the current Greek situation. Here's some of the excerpts he had of this. Again, this is back 2002, 13 years ago. He says, and this is Greg Palast telling Alex Jones, he said, "I spoke to the former chief economist, Joe Stiglitz, who was fired by the World Bank. So I, on BBC with The Guardian, basically spent some time debriefing him. He wouldn't give me inside documents, but other people handed me a stash of secret documents from the World Bank and the IMF. And then Greg Palast goes on to say, "We found inside these documents that basically they required nations to sign secret agreements in which they agreed to sell off their key assets, in which they agreed to take economic steps which are really devastating to the nations involved. And if they didn't agree to these steps, there was an average for each nation that signed 111 items that they would be required to sign onto. If they didn't follow those steps, they would be cut off from all international borrowing. You can't borrow any money on the international marketplace. No one can survive without borrowing, whether you're people or corporations or countries, without borrowing some money, having some credits, liquidity. That's what they're doing right now with the bank holiday. They're shutting it down. People can't get their own money out of the bank because of that." Then he goes on, he says, "I've got inside documents recently from Argentina." This is back in 2002. He said, "The secret Argentine plan. This is signed by Jim Wolfensohn, the president of the World Bank." And he says, "They've not challenged the authenticity of the documents." He said, "At first they did. First they said those documents don't exist. I actually showed them on television." See, that's what happens all the time. They'll always deny that the documents exist. And then when you show them enough times and say, okay, now they exist, but they don't mean what these guys are saying because they figure people won't read them. Well, here's what he said they said. He said, "The problem is we have, look," he said, "the IMF and the World Bank is 51% owned by the U.S. government, by the U.S. Treasury. So the question becomes, what are we getting for the money that we put into there? And it looks like we're getting mayhem in several nations. Indonesia's in flames." He says, the chief economist Stiglitz was telling me that he started questioning what was happening. He says, you know, everywhere we go, every country we end up meddling in, we destroy their economy, they end up in flames. And he was saying, they kind of questioned this and he got fired for it. But he was saying, they even kind of plan the riots. They know when they squeeze a country and destroy its economy, there's going to be riots in the street. They know capital runs away from your country. That gives them the opportunity for the IMF to add more conditions. Stay with us. We'll be right back. Joining me in this segment is pharmacist Ben Fuchs and Anthony Gucciardi from Natural Society. We're going to talk about a lot of vital health issues. We've got a lot of different topics to talk about. One of the first ones I want to talk to pharmacist Ben Fuchs about is the South Carolina shooter was reported to have been on Suboxone, Subutex. What is the implication of that? We always have the central government coming out pressing for gun control, as well as the people in all the states after every one of these shooting events. They never look at the thing that is the underlying connection, and that is the psycho drugs that they're on, whether it is SSRIs or whether it's something like Suboxone. Suboxone is something that's a little bit different than we've seen with most of these other shooters. So I want to get pharmacist Ben Fuchs' opinion on that. Before we do, I want to let you know this segment of the Alex Jones Show is brought to you by the products that we sell at InfoWarsLife.com. Products like Super Male Vitality. We have that in stock now. We have many products that are out of stock. This is in stock. It's a good time for you to stock up. Summer's here. It's now the time to transform your body, time to get healthy. Super Male Vitality comes in the best organic herbs, combines the best organic herbs and extracts to help make that possible. We have thousands that have used it already. You can look at the feedback. We've got over 500 reviews on InfoWarsLife.com of Super Male Vitality. And if you want to look at those reviews, get a bottle of Super Male Vitality, get them while supplies last at InfoWarsLife.com. That's InfoWarsLife.com. Again, joining us now is Anthony Gucciardi with Natural Society and pharmacist Ben Fuchs. Welcome, Ben.
Hey, thank you, David. Hey, good to see you, Anthony.
Thank you for joining us. As I said, we got a lot of different topics to talk to you about. First one I wanted to talk to you about, though, was this drug that the South Carolina shooter was on. Tell us, as a pharmacist, what you know about this drug, Suboxone.
Well, yeah, Suboxone is a combination drug. It's partially something called Wellbutrin. Perhaps you've heard of that. And then the other component is an opiate-like drug, opiate-like substance. The combination is used as recreationally. This kid, Dylan Roof, was using it recreationally. And that's something we see a lot with these people that, quote, go postal, as you know, shoot things up. They seem to always be on some kind of psychopharmacology. And what it really highlights is the fact that you can't mess around with the brain with pharmacology. You know, for the longest time, even doctors looked down their nose at the practice of psychiatry. And even today, many well-meaning medical professionals feel like psychiatry is kind of a pseudoscience. It's based in pseudoscience. And that's because there's no real diagnostic measurements for whether somebody is has a psychiatric problem. It's all based on conjecture and speculation. And even the diagnostics that they use is based on something called the DSM, the Diagnostic and Statistics Manual book, which gets updated regularly to include, by the way, diagnoses like oppositional defiance disorder, internet shopping. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. Oh, yeah, I know the ODD.
You know that's one? I think you might have that one. Yeah. I've been listening, Dave. I think you might be suffering. Right?
They want to characterize me as odd, you know, because I have an oppositional defiance disorder.
Isn't that interesting? But you know what that means? You could be drugged officially, and your insurance company will pay for the drugs. In fact, there are cases when you have a diagnosis from a so-called medical professional of oppositional defiance disorder where you can be medicated against your will.
Yes.
To calm you down from this horrible disease, internet shopping disorder, et cetera, these crazy diagnoses. The point is with any pharmacology, with any drug, you're playing with fire. The human body is not meant to be manipulated this way. And when I talk about pharmaceuticals being poisons, I'm saying that not rhetorically and not poetically, but I'm saying it literally. These things suppress biochemistry, and for some reason or another, we have been hypnotized to believe that we can somehow be better. We can somehow have our health improved by suppressing our biochemistry. Now, this has implications in the human body in terms of the viscera, in terms of the digestive system and the heart and the blood pressure, et cetera. But it has really, really egregious effects when we start to play with the brain this way. The brain is the most complex complex living system in the universe. And to start to drug it, to start to poison it, to use pharmacology to manipulate it, it is fraught with danger. It cannot help but lead to problems like all the things that we're seeing in terms of aggressive behavior and violent behavior. Let me say one more thing. There's these class of drugs called serotonin reuptake inhibitors, and I know you know about these. They're called SSRIs. And this is a new class of drugs, relatively new. It came out about 25 years ago, I think the late 1980s. These serotonin reuptake inhibitors exploit or leverage the misunderstanding that people have around this drug, this neurotransmitter, this chemical serotonin. You know, David and Anthony, many people feel like serotonin, based on what they've heard, is a happy hormone, right? It's an antidepressant hormone, makes you feel like life is good. Well, as it turns out, that's not the case. The serotonin is a vigilance hormone. It's an awareness hormone. It is the alternative or the antagonistic hormone to melatonin. And as most people know, melatonin helps you relax, helps you fall asleep. Well, serotonin does the exact opposite. Serotonin is a daytime and vigilance hormone. And when you start to upregulate or you manipulate the levels of serotonin artificially to raise serotonin levels, which is what these reuptake inhibitors do, you get these hypervigilant states. And hypervigilance is the same as paranoia. And this is why aggressive behavior, violent behavior, paranoid behavior, school shootings, etc., are all associated with artificially upregulating serotonin levels. The bottom line here is, if you have brain chemistry issues, neurotransmitter issues, if you want to work with your brain chemistry, the most powerful medicine in the world for manipulating brain chemistry is called food. And it's or it's called non-food, if you will. And by non-food, I'm talking about corporate swill, as I like to call it, which is the processed food that is pretty much rammed down our throats 24/7 via marketing and via commercials. If you want to manipulate your brain chemistry in a healthy fashion, pay attention to the foods you're eating and pay attention to the foods you're not eating.
Yes, that's very true. And of course, many of the ancient Greek doctors wisely said, let food be your medicine.
Correct.
They understood how that would affect people. And when you're talking about these SSRIs, I think one of the scariest things about it to me is how it, it affects people while they're on it. But then if someone decides that they want to get off of this because side effects or because of long-term health issues or something, once they get off of it, then everything goes really crazy.
That's right. You end up with these withdrawal symptoms. Mm-hmm. And that's another danger that's associated with psychopharmacology is withdrawal from these drugs. And that alone tells you about the potent nature of these substances. David and Anthony, how the heck did we ever get the idea that we can manipulate our body biochemically through pharmacology and somehow be better for it? How did we extrapolate from antibiotics and pain pills, which, by the way, are very important, and praise God that we have pain pills, and to a certain extent antibiotics as well, although now we're reaping the harvest of antibiotic resistance, which, you know, anybody who understood how these things work could have predicted, and my pharmacy school professors did predict it 3 decades ago. So leaving that aside, aside from pain pills and antibiotics, how the heck did the potency and the importance of pain pills and the life-saving potential of antibiotics get extrapolated to using prescription drugs for every single ailment that we have, for degenerative diseases and for psychiatric disorders and for weight loss and all of the things that we apply pharmacology to? How did we get from the point from where pain pills and antibiotics save lives to 4 billion prescriptions served? And I would present to you that it comes through marketing, through branding, through advertising, through routes of administration that have nothing to do with patients and nothing to do with bettering our health and everything to do with the corporatocracy and profit margins. And to me, this is one of the most egregious, one of the nastiest ways that humanity is being manipulated is through pharmacology in an effort to, number one, reap profits and centralize money, but number two, control the population.
You know, I would agree with that. And I would also say it is marketing and it is propaganda. And what they're pushing, though, is two things. First, they're ignoring the research, the real research, that the gut is really the center of all mental activity. There's a deep connection between the gut and the brain, as you know. We want to talk about that today specifically and things you can do to enhance your mental health through redistributing gut health with microflora and everything like that. But secondarily, there is this lie that there is a biological free lunch with pharmaceutical drugs, right? I mean, just take painkillers, you'll feel better and everything's fine. Or just take SSRIs and you'll be happier and you'll have increased serotonin and blah, 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 and everything will be fine. There's no discussion of the negative side effects and the reality that when you put something in your body, a biochemical reaction is going to occur.
Oh, yeah.
Even if it's something good. I mean, you can have too much of a good thing, but these pharmaceutical drugs are not too much of a good thing. They're too much of a bad thing. Yeah. And you're trying to use them to get a free lunch when it does not exist. You cannot just be happier or feel better from painkillers and expect it to go on forever. Something devastatingly bad is going to happen to maintain equilibrium in your body.
Yeah, exactly. And what Ben Fuchs was just saying about 4 billion prescriptions served made me think of McDonald's. You know, this is McPharma.
Like McDonald's.
And you combine that with the junk food, the junk drugs and everything. One of the things that I'm concerned about, of course, is this mandatory vaccine bill that just went through in California. And, of course, you're talking about how they're magnifying the pharmaceuticals for every condition. I see that happening now with vaccines. And, of course, they have every financial incentive to do that because they have no liability for anything that happens if it's a vaccine. If it's an antibiotic or it's other pharmaceuticals, they have liability, but not with vaccines. This is a very scary situation. It truly is. Corporatism out of control.
That's government in your blood is what it is. You see, the blood is the sacred space. In the Bible, we hear the blood is the life. All disease, I say this a lot. I say on my radio program, my presentations, I say all disease is cell disease because I want people to understand that there's no difference in the diagnosis and the different types of diseases, whether it's Alzheimer's disease or osteoporosis or a fatty liver disease or whatever. It all at the end of the day is a cell matter. And it doesn't matter where the disease process shows up because it's all happening at the level of a cell. But even more fundamentally, if all disease is cell disease, all cell disease is blood disease. And cells begin to break down when the blood becomes dirty. You know, doctors will talk about something called sepsis, and they'll say, well, if you have sepsis, that's a life-threatening condition. You end up in the ICU, you could end up dying, and they're correct with acute sepsis. But with chronic long-term sepsis, and sepsis means dirty blood,
Pharmacist Ben Fuchs, we're going to be right back. We've got to take a quick break. We'll be right back with Pharmacist Ben Fuchs and Anthony Gucciardi. Stay with us. Is pharmacist Ben Fuchs and Anthony Gucciardi with Natural Society. We started out talking about the effects of Suboxone. That was the drug that the South Carolina shooter was on. Just before we went to break, we had started talking about gut health. And I think you had a question that you wanted to ask Ben Fuchs about, Anthony.
That's right. So I've always been passionate about gut health because I've understood for a long period of time. I mean, I remember in 2011 reading a study and writing an article that antibiotics were wiping out microflora, good bacteria in the gut. And as a result, they were acknowledging at that point that their immune systems of individuals on high dose of antibiotics was being completely shut down. And then that ties into another article recently. It was a study from a college student. He was eating McDonald's every day for like 2 weeks. Have you heard about this one?
Yeah.
And
yeah,
his good bacteria was permanently destroyed by eating McDonald's. I mean, permanently. That means he would have to supplement with probiotics or eat fermented foods to regain that bacteria, if that even if those strains are applicable. And then, you know, Ben, it's funny, you sent over these articles to talk about today. One of these from Science Daily is decreased social anxiety among young adults who eat fermented foods and missing link found between brain immune system, major disease implications. I mean, how long have we known about this? This is not new. The gut has always been at the center of the immune system and towards mental health. And I think the biggest thing, and my question to you, is some of the solutions for people. And I'd love to get into them as well. I know about four or five things everybody should be doing. Let's talk about that for a minute, how really all these people think they're depressed and even schizophrenics a lot of the times. What happens is their gut health is just in shambles. So my question to you is, let's talk about that for a minute.
Oh, man, not sometimes, all the time. Autism, schizophrenia, mental health issues, pretty much all of them have a digestive health component. And that's why it's so important, number one, to start to supplement with good bacteria. Probiotic supplements are probably the most important supplements you could use. And by the way, for anybody interested in learning more about supplementation or using supplements or getting on a good nutritional supplement program, check out InfoWarsHealth.com, InfoWarsHealth.com, or call 888-789-9277, 888-789-9277. Ask them about the probiotic products, the BioLumen Nightly Essence product in particular, the Fucoid Z product, and liquid nutritional supplements. And these three factors all play a very important role when it comes to gut health. Number one, the bacteria in the gut. And this is so fascinating, Anthony. I love how you caught on to this because this is where the digestive system, this is where bodily health begins to break down at the digestive system level first. I call this the triangle of disease. And it begins in utero, in the womb for many people, and then it really heads into the disease process in earnest, believe it or not, when we're born. Why? Because for most of us, when we're born, we don't get the breast milk that we need that nurtures and sustains these bacteria. And for a lot of folks who are born cesarean section, and one out of three births are cesarean now, the baby doesn't get the benefit of the bacteria that are supposed to coat the baby at the fetus as it comes through the womb. Cesarean sections bypass this coating, and then if the baby's not breastfed, from that point forward, the gut bacteria become compromised. So the breakdown process, the physiologic breakdown process, begins at the digestive system level, and it begins woefully early. Now, second important concept when it comes to helping the gut is to use liquid nutrition. And by that I mean soups and juices and liquid nutritional supplements. I talk about bone soup, where you take a chicken and you drop it into a pot and you let the meat dissolve into the water and you let the cartilage dissolve into the water. Very, very important for the immune system. Also, vegetable juices. Get yourself a high-powered blender and making sprout juices and broccoli juices and cabbage juices are powerful ways to help support gut health. And then finally, using liquid nutritional supplement drinks is a great way to bypass digestive problems and get high-powered nutrients right into the gut, especially brain nutrients. The brain is especially dependent on water-soluble nutrition, specifically electrolytes and the B vitamins. It's, of course, also important, dependent on fat-soluble nutrients. But the problem with the water-soluble nutrients is we excrete them when we urinate. And if they're not replaced on a regular basis, it's very easy to become deficient in these substances. And so replacing your water-soluble nutrients in a liquid fashion throughout the day can be not only important for the entire body, but specifically important for brain health. Between staying away from problem foods, getting on a good probiotic supplement like the BioLumen Nightly Essence, and again, you can find out all about these products at InfoWars.com or by calling 888-789-9277. Getting on a good probiotic supplement, using fermented foods, using fiber to help support the probiotics, and then making sure you're getting enough liquid nutrition, you can go a long way, and I mean a long way, towards reducing almost all psychiatric symptoms, whether we're talking about massive psychiatric disorders like autism or schizophrenia, or just something like forgetfulness or depression. And by the way, if anybody's in a nursing home and dealing with Alzheimer's dementia, nothing is more powerful support for supporting brain health than the B vitamins and helping with the helping support digestive health with good bacteria probiotics.
Hang on right there. Ben Fuchs is going to come back with us with some more excellent advice. Also, we have Anthony Gucciardi from Natural Society. And joining me are Anthony Gucciardi from Natural Society and pharmacist Ben Fuchs. Now, earlier in the program, I was talking about how the Supreme Court's jumping out of its jurisdictional boundaries. But typically the way that happens is with bureaucracies. We've seen the FCC assert its control over the Internet recently. And now we see some very troubling signs that the FDA is going to start making moves against naturopaths. Naturopathy, I guess, is how you say it. But we've also seen them coming after supplementation. But, of course, they're not going to say anything, Anthony, about GMOs. They're going to give that a pass. But they're going to come after natural treatments, natural supplements. What do you know about this, other than the fact that this is something we've seen the government do before?
All this regulation is in the same vein and in the same line as the TPP. Right. They know they're losing the battle because Monsanto, for example, is losing money. Last fourth quarter, 2014, shedding money, losing $128 million, I believe it was. McDonald's is losing so much money now every single month that they won't report on their losses anymore. That's mm-hmm. how bad it is for McDonald's. So they are already losing the battle. And their only answer now is if they can't discredit it, if they can't put out phony studies about how organic is the same as conventional, which they tried to do by hiring one of the people that, believe it or not, was one of the guys that stood up for big tobacco, saying that cigarettes didn't cause heart disease.
That's right. Yeah.
Right. So they tried that, and now it didn't work. Organic is booming like crazy. I've talked to the farmers. They're forced to import international organic produce because they can't keep up with the demands here.
Wow.
That's how big it is. So what they're going to do is they're going to try and force it down our throats. Yeah. They're going to come in with the regulations. They're going to get the naturopaths, right? Because mm-hmm. it's a small sector. It's a small group. But if they can get them, then they can go towards even alternative medicine in general.
Mm-hmm.
And specifically, the TPP, of course, would ban GMO labeling. And Monsanto is more than happy about that, obviously. Mm-hmm. That's the way they're going to do it. Because of the fact that we are winning the battle, they're going to start banning everything, regulating everything, and just taxing us out until they believe they can shut us down by force, because they already tried intellectually and we won that battle.
Yeah, they don't even want to fight it at the local level. They want to fight it at the national level. They just had France ban glyphosates. And so they can go with this transnational committee with their investor state arbitration process. And they can say, hey, if you're going to put labels on our products, they've already done this with some regional trade agreements in Australia. They changed the labeling on tobacco, and they said, well, that's hurt our sales, so pay up billions of dollars.
That's right.
That's the way they're going to do it. They're going to hold that gun to the head of the individual countries. And, of course, if the countries say, no, we're not going to do that, then they're going to say, well, then you're going to be excluded from trading with the rest of the world. We're going to put confiscatory tariffs on goods coming in and out of your country. We're going to kick you out of this trade agreement. That's the kind of gun and the leverage that they've got on that. Ben Fuchs, what are your comments?
Here's the bottom line. We don't need the government. We don't need naturopaths for that matter. We can do all this ourselves. You know, the human body is a healing system. The human body knows how to heal. The human body knows how to repair itself. The human body knows how to build. What we have to be doing, if we're not feeling as well as we should or somehow not accessing these built-in systems, is number one, simplify. And that means focus on food, focus on blood sugar, and focus on oxygenation, making sure you're oxygenated. Between food, blood sugar, and oxygen, you have the three major causes of bodily breakdown and lack of health from a physical perspective. Now, the emotional and mental aspects, and even ultimately spiritual aspects, always need to be addressed. But from a physiologic perspective, between the digestive system, the blood sugar system, and oxygenation, you have the three major causes of disease and the three major ways that we stay healthy, none of which require the medical model, none of which require a naturopath, none of which require Obamacare or any government intervention. Between eating less food, patching up the gut, making sure we stay away from sugar and the corporate swill, making sure we're oxygenating correctly and getting on a good nutritional supplement program, we can do it ourselves with the divine force that's built into all of our cells and built into the human body. So I to me, I don't pay attention to what the government is doing. I take care of my own business. And my own business when it comes to my health or the health of my family is to make sure we're eating correctly, we're on a good nutritional supplement program, we're staying away from the corporate swill, and we're oxygenating by sitting on the couch and practicing slow, deep breathing on a regular basis, not to mention using psychological, mental, emotional, as well as spiritual strategies for health, none of which require the government.
That's a great point. Yes, absolutely. As long as they don't prohibit or force stuff on us, that's the thing that we're concerned about. We look at them taking away our informed consent. And of course, there's two different sides to that. One of them is they can force you to take things. And then the other part of it is that they can prohibit you from getting access to certain things. So that's something we're always worried about.
That's what you were talking about before the break. We were talking about dirty blood. You know, all disease is preceded by dirty blood. The blood is the sacred space. Nothing is supposed to get into the blood unless it's been vetted. And this is the problem with vaccinations. They bypass the body's safety mechanisms for protecting itself, for protecting the blood, and stuff gets right injected right into the bloodstream. This is very dangerous stuff. And if there's a major epidemic of some kind and you need a vaccination, that's one thing. But to have a series of vaccinations that you're just going to stick into a human being's bloodstream willy-nilly, it's playing with fire. It's not right. And for the government to compulse people to comply is just absolutely egregious. And we really need to be doing something in terms of speaking up and fighting about this. I don't know how it got through in California. I really don't. How do people accept this in California? For the life of me, I don't know how this thing passed.
Well, you know, these bills appeared all across the country. We had 20 of them here in Texas, and we were able to shut those down. What they're doing is they're ostracizing people. They're ostracizing people, putting us off into ghettos, whether it's our jobs, whether it is school. They're saying, well, you still have a choice. You know, you can stay in this little ghetto that we're going to create for you, or you can take what we're going to demand that you take in order to move around in society. That's the really awful way that they're handling this. Anthony, you had something you wanted to ask Ben Fuchs about.
Yeah, you know, you talk about informed consent, and you talk about the government kind of not paying attention to what they're doing. I would love to be with you on that. My biggest issue is that so many people don't know what they're eating. You know, they have no idea what the government is allowing in their food because it's not on the labeling, right? They don't know they're eating GMOs. They don't know they're eating high fructose corn syrup, which is full of mercury because they change it to corn syrup, or they can't change it to corn sugar, whatever it is. And it's about this article, too, that you sent over. Few people heading towards diabetes know it, right? So few people heading towards every disease know it. No one knows it. They just wake up one day and they're crying. They say, you know, if something's wrong, go to the doctor. Oh my God, I have cancer. It's almost like they had no idea. And I've talked to people who have diabetes, and they say to me over and over again, I mean, I was eating healthy. I said, well, what were you eating? Oh, you know, I was eating fruit every now and then. I was eating those lean cuisine meals or whatever, you know, total junk that's full of additives that are known to cause diabetes and killing the gut flora, and they don't know it. So, you know, how many people do you think are thriving themselves with bad things and giving themselves diseases right now and have no idea?
It's a big problem. First of all, you have to be a label reader, but you can't even go by that. One of the most important health strategies you could use to get to your point here, to address your point, is eating less food and also fasting and not participating in fast food and lean cuisine. You know, if it comes in a box, you probably don't want to eat it. If they sing a song, you know, in the commercial, you definitely don't want to eat. If there's a cartoon character, you want to run, okay? They don't put cartoon characters, and they don't sing songs for broccoli or for Whole Foods. And, of course, even broccoli with pesticides and with soil depletion isn't going to be the same nutritional – isn't going to have the same nutritional – pack the same nutritional punch as broccoli should, but it's a lot better than lean cuisine and packaged foods. It's very difficult to get quality food in once a food has been processed. The processing – process degrades food quality, and once we start ingesting or living primarily on these kinds of foods, there's no way that we're not going to be exhibiting nutritional deficiencies. If it comes in a box, it comes in a package, if it's heavily marketed or heavily advertised, that's a food you want to stay away from. And eating less food is another strategy, a very important strategy. Technically, they call that caloric restriction. And study after study after study shows that inflammation drops, the immune system improves, energy levels improve, longevity increases, cancer symptoms decrease, autoimmune symptoms decrease, simply by eating less food. We live in an empire of food where people make billions and trillions of dollars off of the kind of food choices that we make. The food industry, the processed food industry, is a trillion-dollar business. In fact, Fortune magazine has a great cover story this month on the food processing industry, talking about how they're being forced to become more responsive to consumers' demands for good food, for organic food, etc. Nonetheless, the less food we eat and the less we interface with food processors and with packaged food goods and fast food, for that matter, the better off we're going to be.
You know, it's really crazy, too, because at the same time, in our primal brains, we see an apple. And I've talked about this because it's so crazy before. You see an apple and you immediately assume it's healthy. Mm-hmm. I mean, you're just wired that way. You see broccoli, like you were saying, and you think it's healthy. But in this new food paradigm, that's not the case. I mean, on
kind of
average,
like Snow White's apple, you know?
Right, right. I mean, you could eat organic potato chips that are probably more healthy than that apple, not just because it's lost its nutrients, but it's because it's been sprayed with DDT or 2,4-D or something like that that is known to be giving you cancer. And the World Health Organization just announced that last week, by the way. DDT, 4 times increase in breast cancer, gives you cancer. 2,4-D, also across the board, gives you cancer. So this apple that you're eating is not just an apple, and it's actually hurting you and killing you if it is in fact sprayed with these chemicals versus something like even a potato chip. Mm-hmm. And that's the crazy world we live in these days, and it's so challenging to explain to people.
You know, they modify things, even like roses, you know, they've modified them for appearance to where they've lost their fragrance. And you look at this with apples, they don't want them to spoil, they want long shelf life, and they want it to look good. So they're doing everything they can to manipulate that genetic modification so they don't turn brown when you cut them. Yeah. I mean, you know, you name it. It's all there. It's hard to know what to eat.
It's almost impossible. That's why the less you eat, the better off you are. You know, take a big breakfast, for example. You know, most people think, oh, you got to eat a big breakfast, right? You got to, even that you have to eat breakfast. Where did that come from? Where did the bacon and egg breakfast come from, the traditional breakfast that we all indulge in every morning? Where did that come from? Well, it came from Edward Bernays, the guy who wrote the book Propaganda back in the 1920s, who was Sigmund Freud's nephew. You know, we get propagandized into eating behaviors. We get propagandized into eating certain foods. The food pyramid is a classic example of that, or the food plate, as they call it. The food pyramid, the food plate, is not based on the kind of foods we eat. It's based on lobbying groups, and it's based on what lobbying groups and in the dairy industry and the meat industry and the processed food industry, what they have decided that it's important for us to eat based on their profit margins. So you're absolutely correct. It's almost impossible to know what to eat. The best strategy is to eat a lot less food and eat simply, and not just eat less calories, but to eat less processed food. So when you talk about apples and you talk about fruits, you know, these things are obviously genetically modified, but they've been genetically modified for eons, and they've been especially been genetically modified to have lots of sugar in them, to be super sweet. You know those apples, that apple, that beautiful apple that's on the screen now, that didn't exist 300 years ago or 400 years ago. Apples were little crab apples. You know, we grew up on small pieces of fruit. We grew up on fruit that didn't have a lot of sugar in them. Sugar for many millennia wasn't available. It's only been the last 200 or 300 years that it's been available. And what's happened is because we have these hardwired drives for certain foods, specifically sweets and sugars, and for calories as well, profit-driven corporations have learned to prey and to exploit these hardwired drives. You know that old commercial, I bet you can't eat just one. They were laughing at us. Of course you can't eat just one, because it's the potato chips are spiked with chemicals that compulse us to keep eating until the bag is gone. So taking control of our eating behaviors, as simple as that sounds, is so fundamental to good health. It's so fundamental to liberating us from a government corporate paradigm that could care less about us or could care less about our families and could care more about extracting our funds from us, not participating in the corporate swill, not participating by eating the corporate swill, driving by, not driving through, as I like to say.
Yeah, you know, you see that all the time. It used to be that years ago when I used to watch television, my family doesn't watch anymore. It seemed like all the commercials were food commercials, fast food commercials, try to get you to munch, you know, if you got something in the refrigerator, or go out and get something. But of course, now most of the commercials are pharmaceutical commercials. That's the amazing thing.
David, the food processing industry and the pharmaceutical industry and the cosmetics industry grew up together with the marketing industry at the turn of the 20th century when we started to understand how the mind worked. You know, we didn't really know about the unconscious until the late 19th century. Sigmund Freud was the first guy who revolutionized brain and mind science because he said there's these unconscious drives. There's these reasons why we do things that are based in our upbringing, how we were brought up, or the ideas that we formed as children. And this was a revolutionary concept that didn't take marketers very long to exploit. Within 20 or 30 or 40 years, all of a sudden you just had the first advertising companies and the first public relations companies. In fact, Edward Bernays is known as the father of public relations. And the first industries to exploit these models were the food industry, the drug industry, and the cosmetics industry. And they all grew up based on heavy advertising and heavy marketing. They got their funds initially from driving the message home that you got to eat this particular kind of food and you got to wear this particular kind of makeup and you got to use this particular drug if you're going to be healthy and you're going to be young and you're going to be beautiful. And we're now reaping the harvest of 120 years or even more of this kind of heavy marketing, and it especially takes place in these profit-intense businesses, the pharmaceutical business, the food business, and the skincare cosmetics business.
Look at the cycle, too. You just hit the nail on the head. I mean, the food industry makes you sick, which then fuels the big pharma industry to sell you painkillers or other pharmaceutical interventions, right? And, you know, I remember going into a clinic and a huge sign on the wall. I'm sure many of you have seen this. Big blue sign says, you know, in Texas and in the United States, the number one cause of death is now painkillers. And as a precautionary measure, we're going to ask you a few questions if you're on them just to make sure you're okay. You know, we're not going to be intrusive in your life, but we just want to make sure. And, you know, I asked one of the doctors about it, and they said, oh, yeah, we can't hardly do anything about it because there are so many doctors that will just hand them out like candy. Many of them ultimately lose their licenses, but we're talking about 12-plus million people that just take painkillers for fun.
Well, they tell you in the commercials, ask your doctor about this. You know, they push you to push your doctor to give that to you because it's going to make your life better, in spite of the fact that they rattle off all these serious consequences very quickly in the commercial. Just ignore those.
They call it direct-to-consumer advertising, DTC advertising, and it really didn't get going until, I believe it was the late 1980s or maybe the early 1990s, and it was actually kind of a big scandal when it first started. Drug companies weren't crazy about it, and doctors weren't crazy about it, but as it turns out, it became a big win. It created a huge windfall for the drug companies. What ended up happening is drugs became branded, so people had their favorite drugs, and drugs became like Happy Meals, and people would identify with certain brands of drugs. This is this false choice of cereals and crackers and prescription drugs is something that we see all the time when it comes to corporate-pushed products. They create a false choice. Why do you think you have so many different brands of cereal? Do you think they're all that different? Do we need 100 different brands of cereal? Do we need 100 different types of toothpaste? Do we need 20 different types of antidepressants? No, this is a way that we create identity. This is a way that marketers use branding.
Hang on, Ben. We're going to go to a commercial break where we're talking to Anthony Gucciardi and Ben Fuchs. Of course, Ben Fuchs' websites are brightsideben.com. and pharmacistben.com. When we come back, we're going to talk about some other things that you can do to take control of your life, because that's ultimately your choice, and you have the ability still to take control of your health. Stay with us. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. We're talking to pharmacist Ben Fuchs and Anthony Gucciardi of Natural Society. And, of course, a lot of us are amazed that California just signed into law this bill that is going to essentially mandate vaccinations, ostracize children so they can't go to school if they don't get their vaccines on the schedule that the pharmaceutical companies and the AMA have dictated to them. But of course, there's been things that have been mandated into our food supply, dumped in without our consent, things like fluoride that they just dump in massive amounts, mass medicating the society through the water supply. I mean, how stupid is that? Even if it was something that I didn't know was harmful, to mass medicate the population by just dumping it in the water, you can't control the dosage with that, Anthony. And you got an article that just came out about that as well.
That's right. So, you know, a lot of bad things have been happening with the TPP, or a lot of bad things, right? But at the same time, we're achieving a lot of victories, with the World Health Organization saying that Monsanto's Roundup, which contains glyphosate, is causing cancer, and DDT and 2,4-D, as I spoke of earlier. And I had actually forgotten that I had written this article late last night when I saw it come out. A new scientific review found there was zero evidence, no evidence, that water fluoridation actually prevents cavities in any way. In any way. They said topically, as we do know, there is some benefits because what fluoride does is it kills everything, including you. So this ties in to the Harvard study that came out in 2012 that we told you about, in which the quote from the Harvard researchers said, the children in high fluoride areas had significantly lower IQ than those who lived in low fluoride areas. So these researchers were concerned by that, and they said, well, is there really any benefit to it, though? And they looked at all the studies. This was a meta-analysis, so they looked at all the studies, and they said, well, there were 73 different studies, I believe the number was, but all of them pretty much resulted in no evidence of helping prevent cavities in any way. So this is groundbreaking. And, you know, the government did just reduce fluoride levels in 2015 in June. So this was very recent. They reduced fluoride levels across the board, most likely because they knew about this study coming out and also because Harvard study, which took them 3 years. But this is huge. And this was in Newsweek. This is where I found it. But this isn't being picked up enough. I mean, this is major, major news. It has no evidence that it's preventing cavities. So why is it still in the water?
We've had the Harvard study that says that fluoride in a high enough concentration reduces IQ. We've had the British studies where they looked, epidemiological study where they looked at different areas where they fluoridated the water, others where they didn't. They noticed a big increase in ADHD. Pharmacist Ben Fuchs, what do you think about this? Because you're a pharmacist. I mean, how do you control the dosage of something, even if it were safe and effective? How do you control the dosage when you just dump it into the water supply?
You don't. You know, when I was in the pharmacy, they have sodium fluoride 2.2 milligrams as a prescription product, and it's regulated, and you take it in a controlled dose. It's regulated as a legend drug, the same fluoride that's in your water. So, yeah, you're exactly right. How do you control the dosage? It's great, Anthony, that they lowered the concentration, but what about people who are drinking a gallon a day or a half a gallon a day? How much fluoride are they getting? Not to mention the fact that fluoride is a brain drug. It affects the brain. Who were the first people to use fluoride? The Nazis and the Russians, when they were working on manipulating the brain of people in concentration camps and in the gulag, the same fluoride that we're feeding our babies and we're drinking ourselves. You're absolutely correct. Fluoride is a cytotoxic element. It kills cells. That's all you need to know. Why would you take a substance that kills cells and put it in the water? Is there no better way to help strengthen people's teeth? Are our teeth so, did the divine force or nature or God make our teeth so weak that only a medical intervention like fluoride can help strengthen our teeth? This is absurd on the face of it. And you haven't even talked about chlorine. You know, is chlorine the best way that we can detoxify our water? What about ultraviolet detoxification? What about ozonation of water? What is fluoride and chlorine doing to probiotics and good bacteria in the gut? So personally, I drink distilled water. I don't want to go near fluoride and chlorine. If you are drinking a lot of fluoride and chlorine, that's all the more reason to get yourself on the BioLumin Nightly Essence and a good probiotic supplement. Make sure you're eating enough fiber and getting enough vegetables supporting gut health.
Thank you so much, pharmacist Ben Fuchs and Anthony Gucciardi, Natural Society. Again, you can get more information at brightsideben.com and pharmacist host on this July 1st, 2015. This has been an amazing day in terms of the news. Of course, the story that we had came out last night late on Infowars.com. Obama removing the TPP's anti-slavery clause while he postures on opposing slavery 150 years ago, but not today so much. But, of course, you're not going to notice that because of all of the symbolism. But even more amazing, as I said before, it's not just the TPP, but it's the PPD. You know, you got the TPP, the TTIP, the TPA, on and on and on. It's all there to confuse everybody. And you know what? The public is massively confused. That's why we're here. We're trying to educate people. That's why we need your help to understand what this is. It's not that hard to understand. Just understand that they're ramming this through on a fast track. They're going to combine the U.S. with a Pacific trading bloc, with an Atlantic trading bloc, the European trading bloc. That's part of a plan that's been out since the 1970s, formulated. That's the basis for the Trilateral Commission that Zbigniew Brzezinski put out, creating economic union so they can then create political union out of chaos. So it's not just the secret directives that Obama has out there. That's what these PPDs, the Presidential Policy Directives, they're executive orders on super secret steroids. You know, it's kind of like, remember Animal House, where the fraternity house was put on super secret probation? Well, I guess the entire country has been put on super secret probation because we're not allowed to know what these secret laws are, but we have to obey them. We're not allowed to know what the secret pronouncements of the secret FISA court are that supposedly secretly modify our Constitution. But hey, you know, we don't have a stake in this. We're not stakeholders. The stakeholders are the lobbyists who set this all up. Just as we were talking to pharmacist Ben Fuchs in the last segment, he was talking about how they have the food pyramid. You know, that's not really a food pyramid. As he pointed out, it's really a pyramid of lobbyists. And we know who's at the top. Of course, there's also the issue that's going on with Greece. It's constantly changing in a state of flux. There's going to be a referendum on July 5th. People are going to decide whether or not they want to accept the deal that's being handed to them by the IMF, the World Bank, the European Central Bank, and others, whether or not they're going to buy into that. I was talking before we went to our guest, pharmacist Ben Fuchs and Anthony Gucciardi of Natural Society. I was talking about this interview that Alex Jones had with Greg Palast back in 2002, and it's in the book 9/11. Descent into Tyranny, because it's very important to understand the mechanism that they use. And here we are, 13 years later, we see exactly how this is operating in the context of Greece, in the context of these partnerships, these transatlantic, trans-Pacific partnerships. As I was reading into this, we had talked about how they used the economy to implode countries, how they even planned on the riots, because the riots were going to be useful tools for them. And then Alex Jones, in this interview from 2002, then asked Greg Palast, he said, burrow into N.M. Rothschild. You'll find it all there. Go through these 4 points. You've got the documents, the IMF, the World Bank implosion. 4 points, how they bring down a country, how they destroy the resources of the people. And Greg Palast says, right. Well, first you open the capital markets. That is, you sell off the local banks to foreign banks. Then you go to what's called market-based pricing. That's the stuff like in California where everything is free market. You end up with water bills. We can't even imagine selling off water companies in the United States of America. Remember now, this is 13 years ago. We've got this massive drought, California. We've got massive moves throughout the world now with big corporations trying to corner the market on water. 13 years ago, we were talking about this. He says, but imagine if a private company like Enron owned your water. Then the prices go through the roof. Then you open up the borders to trade. Complete free marketeering. And Stiglitz, who was the chief economist, remember, he was running the system. He was their numbers man. He was saying it was like the opium wars. This isn't free trade. It's coercion trade. This is war. They are taking economies apart. Stay with us. We're going to come back. We're going to take your calls in the next segment. And we're going to talk about a little bit more about real ID. Stay with us. 2015, I'm David Knight, your host. I'm going to start taking your calls in this segment. I'd like to get your feedback on what is happening in this country because things are changing fast and furious. It does us does not make us feel any better to be so right about what's going on, but we need to understand where this is headed. And as you can see, things moving down this path, just as I was talking about in the last segment, this book, and of course you can get it if you're a member of Prison Planet TV. You can get the PDF of this 9/11 Descent into Tyranny. In the back, there was a section talking about how the banks were manipulating people. We're seeing that happening. Right now, we're seeing it happening in Greece. And just as I was pointing out in the last segment, the same type of stuff that we're seeing happening with these trade partnerships that they call them. They're really treaties. They're just playing a game, playing a semantic game, not calling it a treaty, so that they don't have to go through the constitutional process of ratifying a treaty. That would require 67 votes in the Senate. Of course, they have now passed the Trade Promotion Authority, the Fast Track Bill, which will mean that the bill is not going to have to go through the usual legislative process of getting approved in committee, being recommended by the leadership. No, it will go to the floor for a vote in no less than 45 days once they present this secret bill, the secret treaty that has been negotiated with the corporate lawyers for years. Once they present that, it will automatically have to go to the door, to the floor in no less than 45 days. They will have no right to have a debate or discussion, no amendments. They will be able to debate it for 20 hours max. There will be no amendments. There will be no filibustering allowed. And so this thing is going to be rammed through without the public having much time to take a look at it. This is the way that both John Boehner and Nancy Pelosi have been operating now for the last several years. Bring in a gigantic omnibus bill. Present it to the people in the House and the Senate. You don't give them any time to read it. You say, we got to vote on this the next day. we can expect to see that sort of thing. Because, you know, we're not stakeholders. So what difference does it matter whether or not our elected representatives have a chance to take a look at this or not? And we're going to also talk about the vaccination bill as well. If you want to call in, that number is 800-259-9231. Again, that number is 800-259-9231. How do we deal with this? And of course, pharmacist Ben Fuchs had some good advice. We take control of our lives to the degree that we can. And you don't always ask permission. Just do it yourself. And until they actually put a gun to your head, till they take the food off the shelves, there's a lot of things that we can still do. There was an interesting article on the Daily Sheeple. It was talking about one of the most important aspects of survival that's overlooked and undervalued. And the author, Paley Roberts, was saying, I find it absolutely fascinating when I meet new folks of like mind who offer to teach me numerous additional skills that would be beneficial in the bleak future that seems to be likely. And talks about how, yeah, we can learn to do this, we can learn to do that. But says, here's one of the most effective things you can do to prepare. And I say, get yourself healthy. Make sure that you're in as good a physical condition as possible. You know, when I was talking about the situation that's going on in Greece, remember they're limiting people to how much money they can withdraw. There's a pensioner there who can only get $130 a week out. And he says, you know, that's not much for us to live on. And I can't afford to buy any medication for my wife who's just had an operation. So you don't want to go into an economic collapse like they're seeing in Greece in a situation, if you can help it, you want to be in as good a physical condition as possible. And they gave three different things that you can do with the if it's going to hit the fan. Number one, a person's body will already be at a disadvantage if things go awry. The ability to fight disease, to run away from an enemy, to defend oneself, to survive nutrient shortages will be reduced if you're not healthy. Number two, switching diets in time of an emergency can cause a body to go through a lot of unexpected trauma, which can result in, number one, what we just talked about, being at a disadvantage, not being able to fight the disease. And then, of course, number three, there may not be a doctor around that would be able to offer a cholesterol-reducing pill or a blood pressure pill or pain medication. So the absence of doctors could be due to something as major as an economic collapse or as modest as a shortage of doctors. That could happen, couldn't it? Due to governmental mandates and the economies of government. So what do you need to do? You need to try to make sure you're as healthy as possible. That's why we sell the products that we do at InfoWarsLife.com. We want to make sure that you're as good a shape as possible. We want to give you products that are going to help you as well as things that are going to fund the operation here. We have a new product, Brain Force, as they say, because there's a war on your mind. You know, there's also a war on your health. The average American now has a shorter attention span than even a goldfish. We're having Brain Force here that we're offering here to give you the nutrients to help you with brain health. It's a highly advanced brain formula developed by our chemists to help fight back against the attacks on our cognitive function. Of course, those can come from many different areas. Just as we're talking to pharmacist Ben in the last hour, there's so many different things in the water that you drink, the food that you eat, the environment. Brain Force is a good type of sustainable energy that Alex says puts his brain into overdrive. And you know, I've noticed that from Alex. I thought it was just when he came back, I thought it was just the rest that he had been in, but then it persisted. And as I was telling Anthony, I had a really hard time getting to sleep last night. I basically went all night without having any sleep, just tossing and turning the whole night for whatever reason. I came in this morning, I thought, I'm going to try that. There was a bottle of a Brain Force here, so I took a couple of pills, and it has really made a difference in the world for me today, honestly. Try it today. See what it does for you. Visit InfoWarsLife.com. That's InfoWarsLife.com. I know it's going to sell out at least by this weekend because orders are building up. I want to go to your calls, and I want to talk to people. We really haven't covered what's going on in California yet that much in detail, and this is very important because it's something that's not just going to affect people in California. This push to mandate vaccines was something that we saw happening all across the country. You want to talk about something that is suspicious. You've got a very small minor outbreak of measles. And they use this, just like they use a shooting, to try to further their agenda, to create a crisis, to try to further this nationally. So we had bills that popped up all over the country all at once to take away our informed consent. Now, they don't call it that. They say they're going to remove your personal belief exemption because they play semantic games with the language in order to win. See, they take the high ground with what they call it. You don't call it informing people. You say, oh, you're not informed. You just have a personal belief. The experts, they're informed. You need to do what the experts say. You're not capable of doing the research yourself. You're not capable of making a decision. So we don't need to inform you. And then, of course, it's not consent because everything is mandated. Okay. So we are just slaves who do what we are told, and they might give us an exemption from those mandates, or maybe not. So they take informed consent and they turn it to that. And as I pointed out, you know, informed consent has a lot of different sides to it. It's one aspect, if they take away your informed consent, one aspect is they can force you to take medications. They can force you to drink fluoride in your water, not telling you, not controlling the dosage because they're just massively dumping it into the water. And we know why they're doing it. They started doing it to get rid of the waste of the aluminum and then the nuclear industries. They had a toxic substance that they were going to have to pay a lot of money to safely dispose of, or they could create this fiction that fluoride is going to somehow help you with your health and then sell it instead of having to pay to dispose of it. They could sell it to different municipalities and make a profit at the same time they force you to take it. And now that house of cards is starting to come down because we've had study after study showing the effects, as we just mentioned in the last hour, showing the effects on IQ. Harvard studies showing the effects of IQ in China, as well as British studies showing the effects of fluoride in the water versus areas that did not have fluoridation, showing that there was a massive increase in ADHD because it affects the brain, just as Ben Fuchs was telling us in the last hour. And now the study that's come out says, well, you know, we really can't tell that it does anything to help your tooth health. You think? I mean, if it's going to help your tooth health, you would think that maybe you would apply it to your teeth. And if it was a medication, even if it was safe and effective, you need to control the dosage of any medication. But we are just their slaves. We're just their subjects. And nothing makes that more clear than this situation in California, ramming down State Bill 277. As I pointed out, it's been shut down across the country and other places, but California, of course, they get it through there. Now, here's how it's going to affect all of us, because there are people in California who are not going to bow down and do this. They're going to challenge this. They're going to challenge it in court. It's going to wind its way through the courts. I fully expect, with the kind of courts that they have in California and with the Ninth District Court out there in California being pretty much adamantly opposed to any individual freedom or choice, they're going to ram down a statist decision. It will wind its way to the Supreme Court, and who knows how they will decide, because they don't seem to rely on the law too much anymore. I have to say, when they say that they are going to force you to take vaccinations, of course, they have different ways that they play with this to say, well, we're not really forcing you. You don't have to get your kids vaccinated. You just won't be able to put them in a school, public or private. They even included homeschooling there for a while, but they figured, well, the homeschooler is going to fight us too hard on that. So for the moment, we'll give them an exemption. We'll come after the homeschoolers later. A lot of the homeschoolers saw through that. They were very active in terms of fighting it. But of course, they don't really care. And then what we see here in Texas, this is an article that we had from Don Salazar yesterday. Texas clinics are turning away unvaccinated children. And of course, this is one of the largest healthcare groups in the area here. They have a half million people that they service. And they're saying that they're not going to see your child if you don't want to get your vaccinations. So you still have a choice. You don't have to get it, but they just won't provide any healthcare to you. What do you think is going to happen when the government controls our health care, when the government is telling us what to do and providing our health care? You think they're going to do what the pharmaceuticals tell them? Stay with us. We'll be right back with your calls. People in California, I want to get their reaction on this new vaccine bill that's been put through that's going to take away people's informed consent. You know, we talked to one of the founders of the National Vaccine Information Center. She pointed out that if they're going to tag and track you, if they are going to force you to inject into your body toxins of unknown effect, if they can do that. And of course, it's not just the current vaccines that we have that they are mandating. It's any vaccine that they come up with, and they have every incentive to make these vaccines because they have no liability. So every treatment that they're coming up with is taking the form of a vaccine because they have the vaccine court that you will go to if you were harmed by their product. They have no incentive to do due diligence, and they have no liability. So the real immunity that anybody's getting out of this, you're not getting the vaccines, and we'll talk about that later in this hour. We've shown study after study that shows that the vaccines are not providing the immunity, the efficacy that they're telling you about it. So, you know, putting it together in some kind of a herd immunity, that's not happening. But it's just going to continue to increase because they're going to, the only people that have any real immunity are the corporations who are selling it to you. And again, we had this decision from the Supreme Court on asking for identification proof of citizenship for people who are voting. They say you can't do that. As I pointed out in the first hour, we've had three amendments that touched on voting because there's no specifics in the Constitution. So they put some specifics in, three amendments, 50 years apart, one in 1871, in 1920, another one in 1970. They all had the same basic form. The right of citizens of the United States to vote shall not be denied because of fill in the blank. And it was things like race, sex, age. Now we come to 2015, 45 years after the last one of those, and the Supreme Court comes in and says, no, we're not going to allow you to determine if somebody is a citizen. See, voting is a right of a citizen, but they're not going to let you determine who a citizen is. Nevertheless, starting in 2016, January 2016, you will need to provide, as a citizen, real ID in order for you to get on an airplane. The TSA is going to require that. So you see, anybody can come in and they can vote and we just take their word for it, but if you want to get on a plane as a citizen, you better be ready to prove who you are and show your identity papers to the Nazis who are waiting to mess with you, to harass you, to fondle you. You know, even the Nazis didn't do that in occupied France. It's just absolutely, absolutely insane. What's wrong with real ID? Go to this site here. This is a good place to go for information, realnightmare.org. They break it down. What's wrong with real ID? Well, they say it's real invasive. It'll create America's first national identity card. And again, it's rolling out in 2016. They're going to use the hammer. Of course, they're not going to require you to get that national ID card, just like the vaccines. You know, if you want to go to school, you got to get your vaccine. If you want to get on a plane, you got to get the national ID card. But, you know, we're not forcing you, are we? Huh. Right. It's also going to have real red tape. Going to have a lot of bureaucracy, long lines, they point out, repeated trips, higher fees for individuals trying to get licenses and IDs. Yeah, I tell you what, when I moved to Texas, the process that I had to go through to get a driver's license was ridiculous, all the different ways that I had to prove who I was. Real expensive, because it's going to, you know, somebody's going to have to pay for all this vetting of people to make sure that they're citizens, but not when they vote, okay? Not when they vote. We don't want to do any of that. You won't have to show your real ID ever to vote, okay? And as they point out, it is real pointless. It will do nothing to protect us against terrorism. I want to go to your calls now. Let's go to Mark in California. You had, you're in California. They've just passed this mandatory bill for vaccines. Give us your take on it, Mark.
Yeah, well, before I do, let me say this. I love talk radio. I know all the radio hosts, I mean, by listening to them. And you guys, Alex Jones, you guys are so, you're the best, okay? These guys have people that are knocking on doors, telling people to tune their radios to KOMY 1340 or Infowars.com. That's unheard of for any talk show host. And if there's any listeners that know those guys that are on the radio, they need to tune their radio to Infowars.com and follow the leader. Okay? that's what I want to say.
Well, thank you.
Now, I got 10 kids.
Well, you know what? Hang on there. Hang on there, Mark. I want to find out what you want to say about vaccines. Very important for people to hear from the perspective of somebody there in California. We got to take a commercial break. Stay with us. We're going to be right back. Mark in California, Jeff in California, many others. Hang on. We'll be right with you. Obama's presidential policy directives, the PPDs, which are basically executive orders, except they're secret. You're not allowed, even Congress, is not allowed to know what the subjects are. Isn't that amazing? As Senator Sessions would say, it's breathtaking. Every day we have another breathtaking revelation of a lawless, out-of-control government. They've been putting their hands on our kids at the airport. Now they're going to put their drugs into our kids without our permission. It's just absolutely amazing to me what is happening. I want to go to your calls, get your reactions. We've got several people on the line calling in from California because we've just now seen the government, state government there, remove people's informed consent as far as vaccines go. Let's go back to Jeff in California. Jeff, go ahead.
Mark.
Oh, okay. Let's go to Mark. Go ahead, Mark. Yes.
Yeah, sorry. You know, as Paul put it, in the last days, perilous times shall come. And I've got 10 kids, and my seventh just graduated from high school. We still have three from 11 to 16. And my, oh, my, you know, I pray about this. I really do. And when I heard Alex Jones interview Dr. Thompson, it just, like, it hit me between the eyes. I mean, here's a guy that says he knew it gave autism, okay? And he shut up about it, and now he's not shutting up about it. I mean, this is the high-ranking CDC doctor. You know, how can you reject testimony like that from a guy like that? And it's all about money. That's what it is. Yes. We know there's no logic in it. And so we're just going to, so far our school, more and more people are listening to Alex Jones and more and more are just getting educated without listening to Alex Jones. There's such a huge amount of people out here in California that are waking up to it. Our school in San Jose, you know, quickly, you know, got us, you know, word got around, to sign the exemption. So still there is an exemption so far, you know, that a lot of people believe is going to make it so you don't have to get them back vaccinated. But if it comes down to it, we're going to pull our kids out. They're not going to vaccinate my kids.
Yes.
And I'm going to buy guns. I don't have any guns yet, but if I have to die, I don't want to kill anyone, but they're not going to vaccinate my kids. You know, I have to defend my kids.
Absolutely. I mean, this is just the worst kind of tyranny. I mean, good for you, and good for you for having 10 kids. I know you would tell people that it's a blessing to have kids and not a burden, wouldn't you?
They're both. They're a great blessing and they're a burden, but God says be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth, you know, and they are a blessing. This is what the Lord said.
That's right.
We trust in God and in His Word.
And you know, we have to look at think about this in the context of this recent decision here in California. You know, we were told that, you know, children were nothing but a burden. We could not afford to have kids, so we need to abort them. The Supreme Court, this wonderful Supreme Court, these ring wraiths that we have up there, they said, you know, it's you have a right to privacy. People who support this said, we're pro-choice. Isn't it interesting that the people who were saying that they were pro-choice on a woman's right to end her child's life, they are not pro-choice on a parent's decision as to what medical procedures they're going to have done, okay? That's the lie of these ring wraiths. The idea that there is some right to privacy, how hollow can the right of privacy be? Look at all the revelations that we've had about our government being so incredibly paranoid, conspiracy-minded, that they follow everything that we do everywhere. They're mapping it all together, mapping out our relationships, following us everywhere. They want to talk about a right to privacy only when it has to do with population control, only when it has to do with eugenics. That's when they will tell you the lie that they are pro-choice, that they believe that you have a right to privacy. They don't think you have any rights. You are their slave. They can put their hands on your kids whenever they feel like it. Put their hands on you. They can inject into you and your kids whatever they wish at any time is what they're saying. And I agree with you. I think we need, this is getting to the point where we're going to have to push back with everything that we've got and say, hey, ultimately, you have to understand we have the Second Amendment. If you're going to force inject us with mercury or other toxins, we will force inject you with lead. I mean, that's basically where it's going to have to come down. Thank you so much, Mark. You know, you're not the only one who is talking about this. We had Jim Carrey get on Twitter, and he was very angry about this. He says, Jerry Brown is a corporate fascist who must be stopped. Absolutely. And he is recommending people take a look at a documentary called Trace Amounts, and you can find that at traceamounts.com. I'll read you a couple of tweets from Jim Carrey, because he had some really good tweets. I retweeted him on my personal account. Jim Carrey says, go to traceamounts.com, watch the documentary, judge for yourself. If you really care about the kids, you will. It is shocking. Another tweet from Jim Carrey said, the CDC can't solve a problem they helped to start. Yeah, there's a conflict of interest there. He says, it's too risky to admit that they've been wrong about mercury and thimerosal. They are corrupt. This is corporate fascism. This is the corporations working with the government to not just drive their competitors out of business now, but go to the end user, hold a gun to your head, and force you to take their product. Let's go to Jeff in California. Jeff, you want to talk about vaccines?
Hi, David. You are an absolute asset to the InfoWar. Thank you for taking my call.
Well, thank you.
My nephew is vaccine injured. He's almost 4 years old. And when he got that round of shots before he was one, my sister and I saw the light go out in his eyes. Mm-hmm. Like what you guys talk about, all the people that have called have talked about, I physically watched this happen. So when somebody passes something like this in my state, man, I'm just screaming inside my skin, man. I can't describe to you how angry I am.
That's horrible.
Besides that, here in California, David, you guys talk a lot about chemtrails, you know, geoengineering. I'm a truck driver. I'm outside every day. I've been watching it for years now, and it's real cloudy. It's supposed to be raining, and every time you'll see it get rain, it'll start raining for a little bit, and the clouds split. You'll see in between the split, you'll see the chemtrails, mm-hmm. and all of a sudden, I'll tell people around me, mark my words, it's going to get hot and dry within a day, and it does every time. Right now, it's real humid. It's real cloudy. They're chemtrailing above it. It was chemtrailing like crazy yesterday. It'll be hot and dry in a day, I bet.
Yes, you know, there was, I remember when we did the Paul Revere contest, somebody had a documentary, and they also put up an app. I think it was called Skyder Alert. And what they would do is kind of crowdsourcing the data collection, and they had people report on this app. You can get on your device, report when you see massive chemtrailing. In other words, you see like a crisscrossing grid of what looks like contrails, except they're persistent. And they gradually spread out, and they hang there, and they create a large cloud over it. And what they noticed was, as people were reporting the areas where there was where they would see chemtrails, they'd take pictures of it, they would report it, and then they would mark it with geolocators, and they correlated it to temperature increases, just as you're talking about. I think that's quite fascinating. Yeah, there's a lot of stuff that's going on. Fundamentally, they don't care whether or not we agree with what they're doing. Let me ask you, said you had a relative, a nephew or niece that was affected with a vaccine. What was the problem that happened post-vaccine?
Post-vaccine is like I said, the light in his eyes, you know, that life light that you can, you know, when you look at a baby, you go, wow, this one's going to be a smart one. It went blank. You know, you're calling his name's Braden. You're going, hey, Braden. He's looking off in the distance, drooling on himself. He's almost four now. He's been in speech therapy since he was 17 months old. He'll point at stuff and say, hey, that's a cat, a dog. But other than that, he's speaking his own language, man. He's it's basically the testimonies that you have many people come on your show and talk about. And I physically watched this happen with my nephew. And like, how can people be blind to this or even argue? And especially the point you just made when you said, I tell this to people all the time. Hey, you're pro-choice. You want to murder your baby? But you think that, you know, you shouldn't have a choice or parents shouldn't have a choice about injecting your kids with whatever the government feels like injecting them with?
Yes,
you know,
absolutely.
And you said, what's it? I forgot how many times more vaccines that people have passed, like 1993 versus, you know, say, you know, everybody before 1993 had.
You know, there's a lot of different... There's a lot of different symptoms that the parents have noticed. And again, we had Michelle Roten with Nurses Against Mandatory Vaccines. I had her on to talk about how they're coercing people through the workplace, through their jobs. They're coercing people by saying, we're not going to give you health care. They're coercing people by saying, you can't go to school if you don't get vaccinated. And then they say, oh, you know, we're still giving you your choice. You still have you can still choose about that. But, you know, there's a lot of different ways that we see people react to this. And here in Texas, you know, we talk about informed consent. It's not only being forced to take things that you don't want to take against your consent. It is also having things removed from you that you want to take, that you want to try, natural remedies, things like medical marijuana. And these two come together in a very interesting way because we've had a lot of people talking about how as a result of being vaccinated, immediately their child started having epileptic seizures, uncontrollable seizures. And there was testimony, very moving testimony, of a lawyer in California during these hearings who was talking about how that had happened to his child. And he was testifying for basically just fundamental rights to be able to make that choice for yourself. But he was talking about how that had happened to his son. We had David Simpson here in Texas, a representative who was trying to reform the marijuana laws here in Texas. And one of the things that motivated him was he had several people in his jurisdiction who had adverse reactions to vaccines. Their children had had adverse reactions. They had this ongoing, continuous, and it can be life-threatening. It can take your life, these multiple seizures. And the only thing that would help was for them to get marijuana oil, cannabis oil, and they had to go to Colorado. One of the couples didn't have the money that they could do that. Here's a story out of Mooresville. We've talked about this before. A Mooresville couple, this is Mooresville, North Carolina. Their child was injured and had exactly the same symptoms. And of course, they had to go to the vaccine court. They were able to get some money out of this, but it has completely destroyed not only the child's life, but their life to take care of this child. And the money that is given by the vaccine courts, that's not a sufficient compensation. It is not a real litigation as to what happens. But I find it amazing to see over and over again these stories about children who have an adverse reaction to the vaccines, who start to have these multiple seizures, and the only thing that stops it is cannabis oil. There was just another story about it in New Zealand. They imported the cannabis oil from America for this child, and it stopped it. They just changed the law here in Texas. The first exemption for medical marijuana was for this very condition. They have now admitted in Texas that there is a medical use for marijuana, which says then that it should no longer be classified as a Schedule I drug, meaning that it has no medical use. That was the UN that came up with these drug schedules 1 through 4. The UN created that 10 years before Richard Nixon declared a war on drugs and put those out there. It is a UN agenda, just like UN Agenda 21. These are agendas that the UN creates. They get the local governments to enact them. That's the way they control this. The conservatives need to understand this war on drugs is not only destroying our legal framework, it is also a UN agenda. And they need to understand, too, that in many cases, it is the only antidote to the harm that is done by these mandated vaccines. Let's go to Jerry in Texas. I want to get some more calls. Sorry, I didn't mean to talk so long. Jerry in Texas, you want to talk about vaccines. Go ahead.
Yes, sir. I'm in Texas. I got a two-year-old boy. By the way, Mr. Knight, I just would like to say what an honor this to talk to you.
Well, thank you for calling. Thank you for listening. And,
yeah, right now I've got the earphones on, and I hope people listen. You know, we want to try to increase awareness in the different ways that we have, the different mediums that we have, and one is, you know, through social, the social networking. And it's a little bit shady or sketchy of a thing to bring up sometimes, you know, religion, government, vaccination, stuff like that. But as a new parent, me and my wife have actually come in contact with some doctors we thought were, you know, a lot more understanding here, and we didn't want to get him, you know, he went for his two-year checkup. And they ran us through hoops. They sent three different doctors in to sit down and have consultations with us as to why we needed to get our kid vaccinated. And arguably, he's the cutest, smartest kid you've ever seen. And we imagine, as I heard the last caller mention, and we see it on, you know, we watch the documentaries and stuff. Imagine what it would be like if this smart kid that everybody, you know, he had a lexicon of, you know, vocabulary of over 100 words when he was just months old, maybe 12, 14 months old. Really smart kid. And what they're asking us to do, potentially, if it comes to Texas, and it's too bad for California, is to ask us to weigh out the risk versus reward. The risk being, hey, if you don't get vaccinated, there's these risks that you could get sick, these terrible diseases. But what are those risks? I'm 35 years old. Smallpox, polio, measles. I've never met anybody who had any of that. Mm-hmm. For 35 years times 360 days. And so they want you to weigh this. Well, you know, they try to scare you into it. And we're sitting there at the doctor's office, and I said, you know what? How about we can get some literature about the risks and the benefits of the vaccinations? and they give you this stack of pamphlets that has cartoons drawn on it with, it's a sales pitch. And mm-hmm. I'm a salesman. I'm a pretty good one, too.
Yeah.
I came back and I said, hey, you know, can we get some of the actual inserts from the vaccines themselves?
No.
Declaring what these risks are instead of your brochures, your sales brochures.
Yeah.
And apparently they took the insult to that. And we were just really baffled that in today, especially here in Austin, Texas, where there's a lot of very aware people.
Oh, yeah.
If people are,
you have to educate yourself because there's a tremendous pushback. You know, there's a tremendous pushback from the media because they make so much money. 75% of the money that runs Fox News and MSNBC and all these major corporations is coming from the pharmaceutical companies. Rupert Murdoch has connections to pharmaceutical companies. His son has pharmaceutical connections to these. But I mean, even if they didn't, I mean, they're making so much of their revenue from pushing these commercials. But you mentioned talking about what are the consequences of getting some of these childhood diseases. Look, I'm old enough. I'm older than you. I've had most of these childhood diseases, which means I have a real immunity to it. I don't have some phony thing that makes me think that I'm immune to it. No, I have real immunity because I really did have measles. Here's an article from February this year. Over 100 measles vaccine deaths and zero measles deaths since 2004. This is from New American. You see, what they don't tell you, Jerry, is that there's a risk with a vaccine, just like there's a risk with measles. You know, some people are going to have they're going to have very serious side effects with measles. Not very many. It's a very small number. But there are also people who are going to have adverse reactions to the vaccines. The problem is, we can't tell if you're going to be in group A or you're going to be in group B. We really don't know which group you're going to be in. So you have to make a decision and ask yourself what you feel the risks are. Understand what is truly involved in this and understand what the real statistics say, that there's been 100 measles deaths, but no 100 vaccine deaths, but none from measles in the last 11 years. Stay with us. We're going to be back with more of your calls. We got Gabriel, California, Kevin in Florida, Stephen in Florida, Dan in California. Before we go back to the calls, I just want to let you know this hour of the Alex Jones Show is brought to you by Survival Shield X2 Nascent Iodine. You need to take care of your own health. You need to do things for yourself, for your family. Make sure you're in as good a possible health as possible. Right now, we have X2 in stock, Nascent Iodine. We've been out of stock for quite a while. It's an opportunity for you to not only get it, but to stock up on it. Scientists admit that you need iodine. Without it, you will die. Of course, we have much of our food is depleted in nutrients. That's why you need to supplement, educate yourself, not only what you don't need in terms of some of these vaccines, but what you do need in terms of fresh food, good quality food, and supplements. Get your X2 Nascent Iodine at InfoWarsLife.com right now while supplies last. Now is the time to stock up. Again, that's InfoWarsLife.com. I want to go back to Gabriel in California. Real quick before I do, we hear so much about herd immunity. And of course, for herd immunity to be effective, it has to be somewhat effective for each of the individuals, doesn't it? But, you know, herd immunity is not really working out too well. We had an article back in February when they were still pushing these different initiatives in various states. Measles among vaccinated Quebec kids were questioned. 52 out of 98 teens who caught measles had been fully vaccinated. Here's another one. This is from March 26th. Students contract whooping cough at a school with a 99.5% vaccination rate. Health authorities continue, however, to recommend the DTaP vaccines despite their apparent inefficiency. Then there was this story. It was in the New England Journal of Medicine. And it was summarized as well in IFL Science. This was about Measles Mary. This is a measles outbreak that involved four people in New York City back in 2011. They wrote a paper about it in the New England Journal of Medicine that just came out at the end of last year. In this particular case, it was a 22-year-old who had been twice vaccinated. This individual then came down with measles and shed it to other people who had also been vaccinated. Two of them twice vaccinated. The other two, they weren't sure how many times they had been vaccinated, but they did have the antibodies. And I just want to finish up with this story. This comes out of NPR. And this is the story, a father of a young leukemia survivor reacts to the new vaccine law. And of course, NPR is telling you, isn't this wonderful? Now my child can go back, my child who has a compromised immune system because he has leukemia, my young child can now go back into public school because we're going to force everybody to have vaccines. So combine these, this information I just gave you about the fact that this outbreak of measles that happened in New York was a person, the patient zero, had been vaccinated twice and shed it to other people. That's the other issue. Do you really want your child with a compromised immune system there because they can catch it from people who are shedding it? Besides the fact that when 99.5% of the people get vaccinated with the whooping cough vaccine, it's still not effective. Let's go to your calls. Gabriel in California. Gabriel?
Yes, David. Yeah, I'm in California, and one thing bothering me a lot is that forced vaccination, because I got a four-year-old that's just about to start school. And now I was told that she can't come in because, and it's a private school.
Yeah.
So what I did yesterday was...
Not too private, is it?
Yeah, exactly. So what I did was I went and placed a lawsuit for denying it, and right away, instantly, they said, well, you can't do that yet because the school hasn't started, so it's technically not denied yet.
Oh, you don't have standing, right? You're not a stakeholder.
It's a joke. And wow. And so now, but you know what, I want to encourage everybody, you know what, once everybody just start placing lawsuits on the schools,
yes,
then it's going to start waking everybody up a little bit, saying, hey, look, hey, we can't handle this. This is what we're going. And put
good job. Good job. Fight it. Hang on. We're going to be back in overdrive with more calls, because I want to continue with these callers that have been on hold. I want to go back to Gabriel in California. Gabriel, you had another point to make. You're going to fight this in court, you said, but they would not let you file suit yet because school hasn't started. So go ahead. Tell us what.
I just really want everybody to do exactly what I'm trying to do, you know, get everybody involved by suing, because that's when everybody hears everything and listens, you know?
Yes, yes, absolutely.
Yeah, I just really want that to happen, and I hope it does, because I'm fighting this, because other than that, I'm a business owner in the Central Valley, so it's like, do I really got to get up and move because of this bill? I will not do it.
Yes.
But I'm going to do everything I can to fight it, you know?
And then it's a shame, and if we don't fight it, and people have been fighting it in all these other states, if we don't fight it, they're going to impose this nationally. And, of course, we're going to see a lot of this type of stuff be imposed on us through this mandatory insurance, through mandatory health care, because that's the whole point. The insurance is just a gradual takeover of the health system. We all know that. We will be going to the federal government to get our health care, and they will hold things like this over our head, just as we've seen here in Austin, where you see one of the largest health providers that serves over 500,000 people saying, you're not going to get any health care from us if you don't take the vaccine. Thank you, Gabriel. I want to run on to some of the other people who have been on hold for a while. Let's go to Kevin in Florida. You wanted to talk about Google cars. Go ahead.
Yes, thank you, David. I just wanted to make two points really quick. One, you guys are awesome. Me and my brother are super, super devout listeners to the show.
You guys tell
all the right information. And I know a while ago, Alex mentioned about the Google, you know, headquarters moving to Texas or whatever. But I just wanted to let you guys know that that's not the only place the cars are. I live in Jacksonville, Florida, and I work in St. Augustine, Florida, and I travel 95 north and south every day. And over the last maybe month, there has been an increasing number of the driverless Google cars.
Hmm.
You know, they
isn't that interesting?
The Priuses.
Yeah,
it's crazy, and I seen it about maybe about a week, 2 weeks ago. And what's crazy about it is there'll be a driverless car, but three or four cars behind, there's an unmarked white panel van that I believe is the control thing that mimics it. And everybody is talking about it around here. Everybody at my work's like, oh man, we saw the Google car. So I wanted to get your guys' take on that, because I think it's just gonna get worse and worse. And I really agree with the point that Alex made about, you know, insurance companies are going to charge you as a human to drive your own car now.
Insurance companies to force you out of your car. You know, I wouldn't have a problem with self-driving cars if people wanted to use that for their commute. We were just talking about that in the office the other day. I wouldn't have a problem with somebody doing that as long as they don't have a problem with me driving my own car. But they are going to have a problem with me. Every accident is going to be blamed on me. They're going to tell me that human drivers are the problem, but human programmers never make mistakes. That's going to be the line that they take. And we've already seen the Google cars in California have twice the number of accidents they do other places. And it's interesting because in California, they got some permission with this, but in other states like Texas, it's in a gray area. They didn't get explicit permission. And they drove a self-driving car, Delphi, drove it from California to New York. So they're passing through all the states in between and using it as a self-driving car. I think that's interesting. But yeah, they're going to try to push us out. And it's very, here's the thing. Whatever your preference is, I know there's a lot of people who don't like to drive cars, but understand, they are going to control your movement. They're not only going to just track you, but they will control your movement. They'll do an instant audit on you and say, you know what, you owe this tax or whatever. You're not going anywhere. You're not going to work. You're not going to the grocery store until you pay this. We'll debit it out of your account because, you know, we don't have cash anymore. That's the way they're going to impose this control grid. Transportation is a very important point of control. Just look at what's going on with the TSA. You want to see that kind of control put onto the roads? That's what they're going to do. Thank you, Kevin. Let's go to Stephen in Florida. Go ahead, Stephen.
Yeah, hang on a sec here. Yeah, hey, good afternoon, Dave. Hey, I wanted to mention something. You've been talking about forced vaccination and the effect on kids with, you know.
Quickly, because we've only got a few seconds left. Tell us your take real quick.
Okay. There's a little girl in my church, and I noticed when I first came there back earlier this year that she was blurting things out, laughing uncontrollably, and just, you know, 5 years old. And I asked her grandmother's got, you know, custody over her. I said, well, she...
We're out of time. Thanks. Sorry, couldn't finish the call. Join us tonight for the Nightly News, 7 Central, 8 p.m. Eastern.